as you look, I mean, the mobile app space has changed dramatically in the past 2, 3, 4 years, right? From something that was, you know, a niche market, now something that everyone has. How do you how do you see this continuing to evolve, you know, in both the short and the midterm?
Sure. I mean, there's obviously a huge trend for smartphone apps. And so almost year after year, consistently, we see a huge growth of feature phones declining and these smart touchscreen devices kind of on the rise. And so it's getting more and more commonplace. And so I definitely see the trend being huge continuing forward. We'll just see more and more of that. And it's really, again, figuring out how companies can embrace the mobile technology and make it part of their strategy. A long time ago, people would kind of think about the web, and they would say, well, I'm going to build a website, and then I'm going to build a web business around my original physical business. So you'd have the physical business and the bricks and mortars, and then you'd build, you know, the web business part of it. And so, you know, it took 10 years for that transition to happen. And so right now, we're really at the beginning of that mobile transition as well, where all these established companies are trying to figure out, what does mobile mean to my business, and how do I incorporate that as part of my web strategy and my mobile strategy and my retail strategy and all the other stuff. So it's really another channel, another avenue, and it is very personal. It's always with you. You have it in your pocket. It's very accessible. So, you know, it's just a different way for these companies and brands to think about their consumers and users.
And I think that that's what makes it so interesting, right? And to your point, it's, you know, the website used to be a standalone entity of a business, and it was, you know, like you said, no one was sure what it, you know, should it replicate the in-store shopping experience? Should it just be a catalog? What should it be? And you look at how much that's evolved. So I think that's interesting to think about the mobile space in the same way. Similar sort of question, as we see these different platforms emerging, right? I mean, the iPhone was the first with really, you know, to really push the apps, and then you said BlackBerry, and now Android is ramping up quickly. Which platforms do you develop on? What are the different experiences you've found, and how do you see that potentially changing?
Sure. We focus most of our energy on iPhone development and Android development. That's where we see kind of the bulk of interest. And so we really develop products for our clients, and our clients are developing their products for end users. And so we tend to be targeting kind of leading edge devices. So we see a lot of iPad use. We see a lot of iPhone and Android use. We've explored some of the other devices. And so we definitely see some things in the BlackBerry space and some things on Windows Mobile 7 that are kind of interesting, and we're going to monitor them. I think web is interesting as well, and there's some HTML5 web stuff that's really up and coming, and we're monitoring that as well. And it's really, you know, all of these devices are channels, and so it's really figuring out kind of where the customers are and how to reach them effectively.
Excellent. Now, thank you for that. And you know, I think we're going to move on to the next guest, but we look forward to hearing from you up at the panel. Sounds like some exciting things going on, and you know, you're right in the mix of it. So thank you. Thanks for being here. So up next, I think we have Jennifer with our next guest.
How did it go?
It went very well, very well.
Great. Okay, so we have our next guest. His name is Dan Mellinger. Dan, you are up. He'll be on his way. But just to tell you a little bit about Dan, Dan is the CEO or co-founder and CEO of Socialite, and he's also the founder and organizer of Mobile Monday in New York. So welcome, Dan.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Happy to be here.
So you were telling me this is your first ultralight event?
It is. I'm embarrassed to say that. I mean, I've heard great things.
Come on in.
All right. Step on my line. Yeah, I've heard great things, and excited to be here. You know, it seems like a great, well-organized event. And
are you feeling the buzz and the excitement?
Totally.
We're all waiting at the edge of their seats to hear what you guys have to say.
I can tell. Can't wait to get going. I can't wait to hear about the new companies, the startups. That's the most fun for me.
Well, you know, we're going to give you some time right now. Can you tell us about Socialite and what you guys do?
Yeah, sure. So Socialite, we're a company that basically provides a platform for building location-based content applications. So I founded the company back in 2005, so we're pretty early in the space. And basically, our customers come to us. They want to create a local content app, whether it's a local guide, whether it's a kind of Foursquare for a small area or around you know, an arts organization. Hotels come to us and sort of create virtual concierge applications. And we do this for about 1,000 customers. Essentially, we just make it really easy and simple.
As easy
to make the app. It's really
as easy for a grandmother, right?
Yeah,
that's
so
what you're
easy,
that's
yeah,
what you guys have.
So easy, your mom could use it. Yeah. Who is my mom is a grandmother too, so
yes,
I guess
mom's
it's a grandmother. So it's you can really like just basically get started and in about 30 minutes have what's ready for a really, really nice local application with mapping and social features, connecting to Facebook and all that jazz.
Okay, well, great. I'm gonna go back to talking about Socialite, but I want to get in your Monday, Mobile Monday in New York,
you.
So that you can make sure and tell people about that event.
Yeah, Mobile Monday is like, it's the largest professional organization for mobile professionals worldwide, and then it's also the Mobile Monday New York is the largest one in New York. We have about over 3,000 mobile professionals. We meet up about once a month. Our next event is going to happen later this month. Go to mobilemonday-ny.com or Google us to find it.
How did you guys hook up at Gramercy Tavern?
Oh, Gramercy Tavern. I mean, we just, looking for good venues. That's a great venue for dinner.
So we have
different kinds of events. That was more of a small CEO dinner. We also have large events that are open to the public. Just sign up and go.
Okay, great. So that's Mobile Mondays, everyone in New York, look it up. But yeah, I do want to get back to Socialite.
If you're not in New York, there's probably a local chapter near you, too. It's a global organization.
We're going to start in a few minutes for mobile app startups. Yeah. But why don't we start with giving some advice to people who are thinking about starting a mobile app?
Yeah, sure. I mean, mobile is really, it's relatively new, but it's just like any other digital business where you've gotten to the point, and this wasn't the case a few years ago, but now where you can really launch and get something started relatively easily and relatively inexpensively and iterate and see how the market treats it and keep going with it. And mobile, it's just another platform, so it sort of touches everything. So you sort of have to, but what is the most important thing, I guess, about mobile is take into account the context that people are going to be using your application, your service, whatever your company is offering, whether it's B2B or B2C. Mobile has a very specific context. The context is that it's this device that's network connected that's with you all the time. And it may not have a big screen or a big keyboard, but it is context aware. It knows who you are. It can talk back and forward to you. It's got a camera associated with it. So just use all of these features and the context in which the users are going to be holding their mobile devices and using them as part of whatever it is you're designing.
Okay, Graham's going to start soon, but I want to ask one last question.
Yeah.
What sort of companies, like web-based companies, would need a mobile app? Like, how do you determine that?
Well, I think just about everybody does now, because as long as there's some reason why someone might want to access your content while mobile, may not need an application. Mobile web might be fine, but you gotta now make sure that your content, your applications are available to someone when they're on the go.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. Sorry we don't have more time. He's really interesting. He has
a
lot to say, obviously. Dan Mellinger, everyone. You can hear more from him on the panel, and we are getting ready to start with with Graham Lawler up front.
All right. Thanks.
And David Carlos.
Thank you.
I love that. Welcome. Welcome to Ultralight Startups. You guys are the lucky 130 people here, because I believe you have the last 130 seats. I expect there'll be more people here who are going to be squeezing in corners or on stairs or God knows where. My name is Graham Lawler, and I am the founder of Ultralight Startups, and I'll be your host tonight. So David Carlos here is our co-host.
Hello.
And we will show you the rest of our hosts. So welcome to David. You may have seen these people. If you're watching the live video stream, this event is being live video streamed, you will have seen one or more of David, Jennifer, Dan, and Ray interviewing some guests already this morning, some of our esteemed speakers. And you'll be seeing more of them later. In addition, we would like to say hello to our Boston and our Toronto chapter of Ultralight Startups, which are joining us right now via live video stream and simulcast. So hello to Chris and Nick, and I guess Melissa in Toronto. So hi to everyone out there. And here's our format for today. For those of you who've been to Ultralight before, you'll find this familiar. So we're going to start with about 10 one-minute long introductions by elevator pitch. And today, our new innovation is that the pitches and the panel actually correspond to each other. You can see my hand down there. So that is to say, all of the pitches are mobile related or mobile apps in most cases. And so therefore we have we have a new element to the pitches. We're going to, if you have a mobile app and you're pitching, you can kind of put it down here, and I will navigate around on your mobile app while you are describing it to us. So we got that going. So we got about 10 pitches, and then we're going to take a break for pizza and networking. Those of you who've been to Ultralight before, that should be familiar to you. And then after about 20 minutes, we'll come back, and we will have the panel. And the panel is, you can see, ready to be set up here. So our esteemed panel on mobile app startups and how to make money with mobile apps. Afterwards, here in New York, we're going to a bar called Murphy and Gonzalez, which is about two blocks away from here. And you can find that in the map in your program for drinks. So that is the agenda. So as far as the pitches, we have a contest. And we're giving away a couple of prizes, some of which are not even mentioned on here. Amazon Web Services, which is a sponsor of Ultralight Startups, is giving away Amazon Web Services credits, $200. You can use that for EC2 or S3 or any of the Amazon Web Services services. Also, $300 in media training from Media Training Worldwide from TJ Walker right here. This month, for the first time, we're going to be blogging about this, and we have a number of blogs, including potentially Startup America, which is, associated with the White House and promoting startups in the United States. So you will be featured there as well, potentially. And we'll talk about the tweeting and the hashtags and how the voting works in the Twitter-based pitch contest. Basically, you all in the room will vote for your favorite pitch or pitches by sending a tweet with two hashtags. The first one is Ultralight, and the second one is a hashtag associated with the startup that you're voting for. You'll find more information on that in the programs that you hopefully picked up on your way in. So, David, would you like to talk about the format of the pitches?
Absolutely. So, the pitches are going to be 60 seconds long. We're pretty strict about the timing, so try not to amble along in your pitch. We want to answer 1 to 3 questions from the audience for each pitcher, and we're going to try and keep things flowing nicely. So if you are the next pitcher, we're going to have an on-deck area, I think right over here, or if you are on that side of the room, you don't have to make your way all the way across. You can just kind of hang out there, but so that when it's time for your pitch, we're not waiting for you to get through and knock everybody in the back of the head. The content, your name, title, venture's name. Try and mention your revenue model. That's always a question that comes up, so you don't want to burn one of your 1 to 3 questions on what's your revenue model. If you have a call to action, that's fabulous. We love discounts. We love ultralight coupon codes, so we kind of share with the community here. And you will also want to mention your hashtag. Actually, you know what? We'll do that for them. How about that?
Yeah.
Don't worry about mentioning your hashtag. It will go so everybody knows. Now, this is my favorite part of the presentation here, explaining how a microphone works. If you haven't pitched before, you haven't spoken on a microphone, it sounds weird. You want to keep the microphone right in front of your mouth. Essentially, it should be at good licking distance. You want to be about, don't actually lick it. Please, refrain from licking it, but that's kind of the right idea. It's not hygienic, but if you can keep the microphone within lickable distance, just remember that in the back of your head, we'll be able to hear you, you'll be clear. The audience will be able to hear you out in the world, and everybody will be happy.
Awesome. So, let's see. Our first pitch is Andres. And so Andres is up, and then if you see your name second in the list, which is Carmen in this case, Carmen will make his way to the on-deck area. Carmen is here. Okay.
So stand right out here.
Now we have, just for today only, we have websites and we also have mobile apps. So if you want, if you're in the on-deck area
sure,
and you have a mobile app that you want to show, get that mobile app on your screen and then just put it right here and I will navigate your mobile app while you stand up and pitch.
He wants to navigate himself.
He wants to navigate himself, okay.
This is a do-it-yourself kind of pitch. So speak into that microphone.
Okay.
Okay, and navigate. And we'll have some fun here. All right. Oh, wait, hold on. Got to get the clock for you. My mobile app is just not. It's in my butt.
Oh, my gosh.
All right. Here we go. 1 minute. And go.
Good evening. Did you know that Facebook has over 60 billion photos? Every month,
5 billion photos are uploaded to the social network. Flickr has 5 billion photos in total. This means that Facebook is creating a Flickr on a monthly basis. To put this into perspective, if you have 300 friends, on average you're connected to 100,000 photos. So how do you keep control of your favorite ones and not miss out with the newsfeed coming out with an uncontrollable mass? So I introduce to you our latest creation. It's Pixable Photo Feed. So pretty much, as soon as you log into the app, we categorize your photos and we do smart algorithm ranking. So we actually look at the number of interactions you have with each friend and we can surface the best photos out there. So let me look at most popular photos of the day. These are the best photos uploaded by my friends today. So why are these the best photos of the day? They actually come from close friends and they have a lot of comments and likes. So if I scroll, when I'm scrolling horizontally, I'm actually jumping from person to person. And then I say, wow, this is a really interesting photo. I want to see more of this. I scroll up vertically and I actually look at the album.
And that's your time.
Thank you very much. You can download the app at Pixable.
Nice. Great. Ooh, applause.
Andres, you might take some questions.
So sure. Any questions about the app or anything in general?
I would, for those of you who have seen our YouTube page, which if you haven't, you should check it out. You'll notice that one of the featured videos, if not the featured video, is when BBC came in and produced an episode or a segment about ultralight startups, and Andres was there pitching Pixable. This was about maybe a year and a half ago. Yeah. When Pixable was a much smaller and younger company, and he's come a long way.
Okay, questions? Wow, it's the app that explains itself. All right, right there. And the question is, can you modify what makes it interesting in terms of pictures?
So this is pretty much like Pandora for photos. So you select like, oh, I want to see this category, and we do smart ranking. But then you can do like Pandora, more or less. I want to see more photos of this person. I want to see less photos of this person. At the same time, you can follow your friends. So let's say that out of the 300 friends that you have, there's only 5 or 10 that you really want to keep up to date with. You follow them, and you get real-time alerts every time they upload or they're tagged in a photo.
Next. Okay. How do you guys make money?
So pretty much our mission moving forward is to be the place that aggregates your photos from all the social networks. Like what's happening now is that there's a lot of fragmentation out there. Like there's Instagram, there's Facebook, there's Flickr. So a lot of photos are going out there and it's really hard to actually find them. It's really annoying. You actually have to jump from person to person inside Flickr or Facebook and aggregate them. So this is actually a huge opportunity because if I ask yourselves here, like who likes seeing photos? Probably almost 100% of people want to do that. And they want to do it on a daily basis. So it's a very powerful problem. There's actually a big problem of fragmentation. Nobody's addressing it. So for us right now, our priority is to be first to market an iPad, web, and an iPhone. And once you have critical mass, because we think that this is a huge opportunity, there are many ways in which you can monetize advertising, printed products, digital goods, and stuff like that.
Okay, one last question.
If there is one.
If there is one. Okay, right there. Are you planning on making your own social network?
Yeah, it's a good question. And like our value is more about aggregating social networks and creating conversations around them. And our value is more about the aggregating and not having people have to sign in and just create a whole different network. I think that's actually the pain point. We don't want to create more fragmentation. We want to bring everything together. We don't want to create a new social network and then it's a walled garden and then it's really hard to jump it. Like the idea is that everything comes to you.
All right.
That's what I meant. Like, no follow-ups.
That's it. Great. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thanks,
Andres. So Carmen is up. You want to throw that down there?
Sure.
And
orient the way I want.
Okay, give him a mic.
I'd prefer this if I could.
Okay, you can do that.
That's cool.
And Eric is on deck. We're all set.
I'll just leave it there.
You ready?
Give me the time.
Okay.
Do you want to drive your app?
Not really. I'll just get it set up so people can. Yeah, that's.
Other way.
I'm making it sillier, aren't I? Hold on. We'll just leave it up as an example of what I'm going to talk about.
Great. All right, and your minute starts now. Yes.
Background, Talking Android, I'm Carmen D'Alessio from Talking Android. We have award-winning Android development in our shop. The opportunity is for all of you to create your own mobile apps in a simple and easy way. There are two keys to that opportunity. One is to focus on data-driven apps. The app that's being shown there has all the parks data from New York City. You can search on basketball courts, you can search on beaches. So data-driven apps, because your data is interesting to you and engaging data makes engaging apps, and two, easy to create. Blogger changed the world. People were learning HTML and making their personal web pages. Blogger changed that by making it really easy to do. So think of this as the Blogger or WordPress of creating mobile apps. Revenue, freemium model, depending on the volume of data and your plugins. So if you want to plug into Salesforce.com to restrict access, then you'll pay for that. If you have 800 million photos like the guys at Pixabay do, then you'll pay for that. Team, I'm doing this and I'm pushing. I have some great advisors from great companies that I'd like to turn into co-founders.
All right, and that's your minute. Great.
Questions for Carmen, right here.
Don't forget the mic.
What plugins do you have?
We're at the prototype stage, but what we anticipate is Salesforce.com, 37 signals, right, the Basecamp stuff. Too much data is trapped out there in your business, right? I talked about kind of the personal side, I didn't talk about the business side. I don't know any business that doesn't have important data stuck in a spreadsheet that you should have at your fingertips. We're gonna make that easy to get at your fingertips.
Right, next.
No problems.
You can talk to me later.
Any other questions?
Is this anything like Red Foundry?
I'm not sure if I remember what Red Foundry does, but StackMob is out there. What they do is make a back end for mobile apps. They're one to look at as a comparable, but they're focused on developers. I'm focused on end users. The other one I would look at is AppMaker, which is focused on consumers, but doesn't have that data hosted in the cloud element. And we're using Amazon SimpleDB and Amazon Cloud Services to do the back end.
One more right here. Do you plan to have a way for users to be able to plug in data?
Yes, it should be put and get.
Put and get, there you go. That's it, three questions, great. We're done. Cool.
Okay, thanks, great. Carmen. So Eric, I think it's probably better if you stand up here.
Yes.
And then you take this microphone, licking distance, stand up here.
This doesn't show the whole thing, but I think you'll get the message. This is just a video.
Okay.
So it'll just play behind me. Hi,
go ahead.
My name is Eric Wood. I'm president and co-founder of Jagamo, the social mashup. Jagamo is part game and part social network. What you do is when a person starts a Jagamo round, they create a topic and then they add a word or words or a photo. And then they toss it to the server. And when the server gets it, the server chooses random people from all over the world and sends them a notification that says that they have a Jagamo. Then those people that catch it have 5 minutes to add their own words or photo. And then when the Jagamo round ends, everybody can go on and see the results. They can look at all the tosses. They see a map of where all the tosses came from, like and dislike, comment, and share it. It's pretty addictive. People get addictive. They like the temporal nature of it, the time limits, and they like the competitive cleverness and the camaraderie of it. It's targeted to people who like to be creative on the spot. And our revenue model is advertising, and it gets above average impressions because of the call and response nature of the app.
That's your time.
That's it. It's free.
All right. It's free. Yay. take a step over. Just to answer questions. Okay. So questions. We'll take one right here.
Is there a concept of leveling up like in other types of games?
Is there a concept of leveling up like in other types of games?
You mean like a point system, like a a leaderboard and thing like that. Yeah, it's in the works for the release after the next release.
Okay, maybe out there, right there.
What sort of revenue can you expect for a single user at any given point in time?
Revenue can you expect for a single user at any point in time?
If the revenue model works as we laid it out, it's about $4 per user per year. But we also have a paid version of the app that would have no ads, so that somebody would just pay it. We'd also get the money that way from them.
Ah, there you go. Right over there. What happens to all the content that people are creating?
It's all published and it's just out there on the web. Like, we're totally open. There's no privacy at all. So anybody that wants privacy should not come and do anything here. On the other side, though, it's totally anonymous. You don't have to tell your real name. You don't have to tell your real. You can be totally whoever you want there.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Eric. We have Barry. Am I pronouncing that right?
Barry.
And on deck, we have Richard Yang.
So toss it up there. Yes, and this is the spot right here, it turns out.
That's the magic spot?
Is ideal for lighting. Now I don't have a microphone. Go ahead. No, take that. Take that, Barry. Okay, go ahead.
You're ready. Go for it.
Hi there. My name is Barry Simon. I'm the founder of What's on Tap, which is an app for the brew-seeking, bar-finding, thirsty-for-knowledge, hardcore craft beer enthusiast. Basically, in a nutshell, what it does, it allows you to search for your favorite brew by current location, neighborhood, beer, or bar. There's a thorough database of over 2,000 beers right now, links to breweries, as well as a feature to favorite beers and bars. Active bar members can sign in through the website to manage their events, their bar information, as well as their current beer list. It's been active in the iTunes store for about 4 months now. It's starting to get a lot of momentum. It's free to download, and it's also free for the bars to participate if they update their own beer menu. I'm here actively seeking some financial assistance would be great because there's been great need to develop on other platforms. It's only on the iPhone right now, as well as possibly a business savvy partner to help me figure out how to monetize it as well as continue to launch in other markets.
That, perfect.
Wow. Well timed. Questions for Barry? Owen.
Can you invite friends to join you?
You currently cannot invite friends to join you. The community really exists of all of the users, the bar members, the breweries, and the distributors that all have to kind of participate together in order for it to be successful.
Okay. How about right here? How did you seed the database? Where did the data come from?
I pretty much built the databases myself. There's a database of beers and bars, and it just came through me going into the websites of all the bars and seeing what's currently on tap and going to the brewery website, putting in all the information, and just word of mouth and my knowledge of the craft beer market in New York.
All right, back to do you have any statistics on how well you're keeping it up to date in terms of participation?
I do not have any concrete statistics. It's really just me going around, interacting with the bar owners, talking to the users, and it's still in like the infancy stages right now, but I don't have anything concrete, unfortunately.
Thank you.
Excellent. And don't forget your phone. There you go. All right. Is that coming up? That looks great.
Hello.
All right, go for it.
Well, I'm Rich, and all of us travel for different reasons, be it art, be it architecture, or be it adventure. However, if you guys look at the current traditional guidebooks, they are all static, and they're heavy, and just out of date. So that's why we created Street Mosaic. It's a real-time social travel guidebook. And the idea is that you take a picture, you write a quick advice, and you share that with the community. The whole process works pretty easily, and you can explore what's around you, look at the photos that you've taken, see what's interesting, and get an idea of what's going on. Our call to action right now really is we just launched our beta edition, so we're looking for users, we're looking for people to really just crash our system and figure out where all the issues are. So that's it.
Great, all right. Questions for Rich? How do you manage quality control?
Right now, that's exactly one of the reasons why we need beta testers, because we want to see what exactly people are posting. Obviously, there's certain controls within tourism. Like, obviously, we want to promote sex tourism, or we want to do maybe more like architecture or, you know, beers or whatnot. So that is one of the issues we're trying to deal with now.
For infrequent international travelers who often don't have access to data, like on the go, wherever they are, yep. Do you have like an offline mode? Is it usable?
That's what we're actually playing around with. We're trying to figure out how to give people the opportunity to tag or bookmark certain locations that they want to go to. Given that this is a location-aware product, the GPS factor doesn't require Wi-Fi. And we're trying to play with different technologies so you don't need the Wi-Fi, but still be able to get to the location that you want to.
Okay, that's it.
Okay, thanks, Richard. And I think Ilya is not here, unless I'm wrong.
Come Come on.
Okay, your minute's ticking away. That's 5 seconds, right there.
Right over here.
Come on, stand. Right in front, right up here.
Right there.
Unless, do you want to drive your app, or do you want Graham to drive it?
You can just leave the site.
Okay, so come up front.
Right there, boom.
Hi, my name is Ilya Zadalovsky, and I'm the founder of MobileStud. MobileStud provides mobile applications for our hotels. So when you're as a guest, when you check in, you could see a restaurant menu from the hotel. You could see your do express checkouts, a wake-up call, and more importantly, you could see virtual concierge services available around you. So we are a B2B play, so a customer in our case is a hotel. Our revenue comes from integration services. So we integrate with the hotel's property management system, and there's also ongoing licensing. It's two of us, it's myself and my partner, Marina. Our development is being done in Ukraine. We have two developers and staff, and I'm looking to meet any other individuals involved in the hospitality area and speak about cross-platform development.
You've got 13 seconds. Tell us your revenue model.
So when we come in, there's some integration that we need to do with each specific property, PMS. That takes, depending what platform they have, it could take 3-4 weeks to get it done, and then ongoing licensing per number of rooms licensed.
Good. Questions? Do you have any hardware deployed at each hotel?
So we initially, one hotel actually wanted to give out iPod touches as a device, but for all the hotels, what we do is pretty much provide their mobile application that the user installs. So we do not do any mobile, if any physical hardware. If they choose to, they're purchased themselves, but that's not something we do ourselves. I'll pick somebody in the back.
Do you allow checkouts through the app?
So once it's fully integrated, yeah, express checkout is done on the app.
All right, that was a quick one. One more. Is it one app for all hotels?
So
or
we
can
have
you customize?
A CMS that powers the back end of it. There is a boilerplate, so pretty much each hotel gets a specific look and feel. However, we do make some custom based on the hotel's needs.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Ilya. Okay, Brett is up. For Peter, we have a dedicated sponsor seat right up here in the front, if you'd like it. And for one other person that is willing to enter the seat raffle, I see one right there and maybe right there.
Thanks. Go ahead and if you, anyone wants to check in, it'll make this more exciting.
All right, go ahead.
There we go. So, hi, I'm Brett, and my company is called Sonar. We've been working on this for 4 months. You guys are some of the first people to ever see it. So, Sonar is pretty simple. It shows you how you're connected to the other people in the room. You open up the app, and it tells you that this guy right here, was a friend of someone I went to summer camp with. This guy in the corner is a VC I follow on Twitter, and the cute lady back there also likes Arcade Fire and Hemingway. So I guess let's check out Stern School of Business. That's hot. Although, where are you guys checked in? Here or Kaufman? Oh, let's go back. Let's go check that out. So it's pretty much that simple. We want it to be go down a little farther. There we go, Kaufman Center. We, at this point, are analyzing Foursquare, Facebook, and Twitter, and sorting the room by who's most relevant to me. That's about it. Who wants to know who you're connected to in the room?
Great. All right. Questions?
Maybe click on Tim.
Click on Tim. Tim has a question. All right.
Hi. No, I'm just saying hi because you picked on me.
Hey, Tim! Tim, do you know who our two Facebook friends are?
I have no idea.
Let's check it out.
All right, one more quick question over here.
Emily, good choice.
Is there a call to action after you found somebody?
Yeah, you can follow them, friend them, you can message them over
Stalk
Twitter.
Them.
Oh, easy there. You can make friends. It's about taking your online identity offline and connecting.
How is this different from Agora?
Well, I know Pierre, and he's awesome. But I think you don't really have enough context with the introductions. I mean, he built that in a weekend, right? So we're integrating Facebook and doing analysis on Twitter. And we're actually about to add a couple other fun things, which What would you guys like to see added?
We'll have to take it offline.
They asked the question.
Yeah, they asked the
question. They asked the question. Okay, cool. Thanks a lot.
No, find Brett and ask him questions later.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you so much, Brett. Don't forget your phone.
Right, your phone.
And who do we have on deck next? We don't see anybody here. So Brian Watts. Okay. And then on deck after him is Ian Smith. So Ian, if you're around, make your way. Oh, excellent. Okay, so I would say, do you have a mobile phone that you want to show or no?
Yeah, I have, but there's not really much data in there.
Okay, that's fine. We'll just show your website. Okay. You're going to stand right there, and here's
all
your
right.
microphone.
Okay. All right. My name is Brian Watts, and I'm the owner of Green Car Budding.
Brian, lick your mic.
Creator of Green Car Budding. And, okay, so the question is, I just blanked on that there. I'm sure anyone in the audience here who lives in Manhattan will have found that finding parking in the city is very, very difficult. What if you could, when someone is just about to vacate their parking spot, go in there and take it just in time? The way that Green Card Buddy enables you to do this is through sharing of credits between parkers. The way this works is you give someone a credit when you donate your parking spot, and you receive a credit, and you use that credit in order to reserve your own parking spot. So
That's a minute, but I'll give you 10 extra seconds. Go for it.
It's an iPhone-based application and also a web-based application, and there's also a Facebook interface in the works.
Nice. Okay. I'll take some questions. Okay, so when I know I'm going
to
leave...
And you want to donate?
I have a parking spot. When I'm going to leave, what do I do?
You just mark it on the map, indicate what time you're leaving. People can look up within a certain radius your parking, whether there's parking in that area, and they reserve the parking spot with you. You get their identification, they get your identification based on their car, first three letters and yours, and the other description of the car, and then they arrive just in time as you move out. There is a communication from the phone, anonymous communication that allows you to communicate as you're nearing the rendezvous time.
All right, and somebody who hasn't asked a question, I hate to shut down. No? Okay, fine. Somebody who has, go for it.
Can I set up a bidding system for my parking spot?
Can you set up a bidding system for your parking spot? I think you just found your revenue model.
There's the revenue model. Well, you could. There would be nothing to stop you from doing that.
But it's not built into the app.
No, not built
into the app. Okay. So that's it for questions. But I do want to mention that we've got hashtags for everybody. So if you're going to be, if you now want to tweet into our Twitter contest, we've got hashtags. So let's go through them. If you liked Pixabay, it is #Pixabay.
Right. So you're going to send one tweet with two hashtags in the same tweet. The first tweet. First hashtag is ultralight, pound ultralight.
Pound ultralight.
Second hashtag is Pixabay, let's say, if you were to vote for Pixabay, which I think would be nice.
We have them up, right? Okay.
Also, it would be nice to vote for Talking Android, and if you did that, it would be pound talking. Anybody here in New York and possibly in Boston and Toronto, I don't know how you're set up, will have that on your printed handouts that you got on the way in.
Ooh, good.
Anybody that is watching on Ustream from home or an office, if you go to ultralight.tv, you'll see links to all of these sites, and you will see the hashtags and very convenient tweet to vote buttons next to each one. That's arguably the most efficient way to do it.
We try to make it easy.
So yeah, many ways to vote, and hopefully you'll figure that out. So here we go. Ian.
Thank you. So no need to drive.
Okay. And go.
Hi, so I'm Ian Smith. I'm the co-founder and chief marketing officer of FizzWaz. And FizzWaz is dedicated to helping consumers, people, make money from the photos and videos that they take on their mobile phones. So right now, through our free mobile app, you have three opportunities to make money. The first one is you can enter photos and videos into contests through our Facebook contest platform. Secondly, you can fulfill assignments sent to us by media companies. And finally, you can sell opportunistic photos through our auction, our online auction. So right now, our growth is going to come from consumers moving through a value chain from entering contests to fulfilling assignments and then ultimately selling in the auction. Right now, our revenue model is we actually charge companies to run contests and to post assignments, and we take a percentage of revenue from everything sold in the auction. We have currently 78,000 people using the application in 121 countries, and we're funded by a combination of VC and founders' money, and we're looking for cash.
And that's time. Applause and questions. Go for it. All right, questions. Do you have any trouble with Apple taking their commission?
No, because the actual auction takes place on our website.
Can a news agency search by time and geography?
They will be able to, yes. You sign up as a buyer on FizzWoz, we ask you what you're looking for, and then you can actually then, whenever we get something through the app, then it's location driven. We then tell the news agencies where it is and what it is, and then they have a chance to bid.
Okay, one last very quick question.
But they
yes, they can.
Okay.
What about rights?
What about rights?
Yeah, so it's right now it's a copyright transfer. So you're buying the rights of the image. We do have a licensing platform coming up.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, Ian. Okay, and if you would like to vote for Ian and FizzWoz, you will tweet a single tweet, two hashtags, Ultralight and FizzWoz, FizzWoz.
It's not showing up, so it's a little washed out, huh?
It is a little washed out. However, we can get your website up,
yeah.
That's for sure.
Let's go with the website.
Yeah. I can't even play your video. Ray is playing double duty here today.
That's right. That's right.
A minimum. Have you run any ultra marathons yet today?
Saturday.
Saturday, okay.
Great. Hi, guys. My name is Ray Bernays. I'm the founder and CEO of Socialibrium. At Socialibrium, we provide simplified and automated relationship management tools that automatically consolidate your interactions with people that you come across every day. So your phone calls, your emails, your text messages, and your meetings. And what it does is reflects that activity in a color-coded dashboard or heat map, where it highlights the gaps you have in that personal professional network. So not necessarily the people you're calling or meeting with the most, but the people with whom you should be meeting or you should be calling. So we have a combination of people, sales professionals and people in the relationship management business, like wealth managers, lawyers, accountants, using this application either as a supplement to their existing CRM system or as a replacement for some of these, you know, really heavy-duty sales tools. We have a subscription-based model, so users paying either monthly or annually, and we have a mixture of individuals and enterprise licenses out there. So right now it's available in BlackBerry's App World, and we're running a promotion on the application. So if you want to try it out, have a look, and or get me at the break.
All right.
Any questions?
Why did you start with BlackBerry?
Well, the primary user is business users, and up until really the past couple months where Apple has improved the enterprise friendliness of the iPhone, BlackBerry's been it. And also, we started out, we have a jailbroken version on the iPhone because the APIs that we need on the iPhone, we don't have access to. Any other questions? Okay, one back there.
What is the use of the website?
So right now the website is effectively a brochureware. There's no website, there's no web backend. Everything is native to the BlackBerry device. So from a security standpoint, everything remains local. So it's subject to your local security policy. We are working on a web backend that would help you integrate with, say, a website. But right now that's not up in production. Yes, I mean it's kind of what you see. I mean the device, the application itself is 100% native. It sits on your actual phone.
All right.
Great. Perfect. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Yeah. Wonderful. Thanks, Ray. And you may see Ray later on at the break interviewing some of our pitch contest winners.
if Ray manages to win the pitch contest.
He's going to have to interview himself.
That'll be very interesting.
How did you get to do this? Well, you know, I did it. Oh, yeah. He's going to get dizzy.
He will. He will. Well, I think everybody should vote for Ray just to see that happen. if you're interested.
Thank you.
Okay. So our last pitch, Shanif.
Yes.
Shanif is right here. Excellent. By the way, if you want to vote for Ray, it's pound ultralight and pound social. Two hashtags, one tweet. So throw your app up there. And who's talking?
Hey, everyone. My name is Shanif Danani. I'm with OGolf. I'm also with Jordy and Mark right here. Sorry we're not on the brochure. We got in late. But we are basically an iPhone application company that lets you download golf courses across the U.S. and use them as personal and use the application as a personal caddy in your phone. So what we do is we provide golf course imagery for all of the courses and let you basically calculate distance, look at your shot tracking, and look at statistics so you can improve your game. So we actually have currently a beta product up on the iPhone App Store, received about 1,000 downloads when we first released this. So why is this important? Essentially, we have about 30 million golfers in the U.S. that buy devices to lower their scores. A lot of our competition right now has a lot of issues, particularly the mobile guys require internet on the golf course. And for those of you that golf, you know that there's no internet out there. We actually let you download the images straight to your phone. So what we're going to do in order to make money is essentially provide these courses to the clubs and have them help us market it to their members and basically sell it to them.
All right. Good.
How much does it cost?
The annual subscription, so you get one course for free. The annual subscription for all courses in the U.S. is $60 per year.
Not bad. Okay.
Go ahead.
GolfShot GPS has a similar product for about $30.
Absolutely.
GolfShot GPS, very similar.
GolfShot is our main competitor on the app, on the mobile space. What they do is they require Google Maps. A lot of times, Google Maps just does not work on the internet, as well as they also have a significant battery drain, which we've kind of worked with a little bit. So we believe that based on the smoothness of our interaction on the golf course, we are actually better than them.
What are your plans for the international market?
So after we roll out to the U.S., we do have a couple of contacts in Barcelona and a couple of other countries in Europe where we're going to download it, where we're going to get imagery for the courses in Europe, and then we're going to expand after we've covered the U.S. market.
All right, one last. Do we have a question from?
A question from Ustream. How did you obtain the photos and the data?
We do have a source that we use. Currently, it's a trade secret, but we do have a source that provides us imagery for basically all the courses in the U.S. We actually then enhance the imagery based on a set of processes that we've developed.
All right. If you have more questions, be sure to tweet what's his hashtag?
OGolf. OGOLF.
OGOLF. There you go.
Thank you.
Okay, that's the end of our pitches. What we should probably do here is remind everyone of the hashtags. So, David, you want to maybe read these off and go through that process?
Okay, so for anybody who can't read or for some reason can't see the screen and is just listening to this, here are the hashtags. Remember, it's pound ultralight and then pound pixable. We've got pound talking, pound Jagimo, that's J-A-G-I-M-O, pound Watt, W-O-T, pound Mosaic, pound Mobilestead, which I thought he said mobile stud when he first came up, but it is Mobilestead, which is S-T-E-A-D, pound Sonar, pound Green, pound Fizzwaz, also sounds kind of dirty, pound Social, or pound OGolf. All right, so be sure to get those tweets in because we're going to be counting them
soon. Very soon. I'm going to do some mentions of various important messages.
Okay.
And then we are going to tally the votes, and the top three are going to get wonderful prizes that really are going to launch their startups into a stratosphere. So continue voting. You can vote for 1, 0, 10, 12, or anywhere in between. All right, so while you're voting, I am going to make some important announcements. So
We have I've segmented our sponsors here tonight into gold sponsors and local sponsors. This is the first time this has happened at Ultralight Startups. So here's a sneak peek. These are the local ones, and these are the gold ones. So, Duane Morris. Duane Morris is a full-service international law firm with more than 700 attorneys and 24 offices. Peter Rothberg. Peter, you want to stand up?
Yep.
Peter, right here, front and center. Peter is a partner with Duane Morris. Peter specializes in corporate law with a focus on corporate securities, venture capital, mergers and acquisitions, financial transactions, and digital media company representation. Seems highly relevant to this audience, Peter. He represents Ultralight Startups itself and more Ultralight members than any other lawyer. So if you would like to find Peter to represent your firm, you can find him right here. And he's got his handy dandy placard in front of him. So thanks very much, Peter.
Thank you,
Graham. OK. Microsoft BizSpark. I don't believe there's a Microsoft rep here, but Microsoft is a sponsor.
Do you want me to read Microsoft? I can pretend to be
sure,
Microsoft.
Sure, there you go.
All right, here we go. Ready? Microsoft BizSpark is a global program that helps software startups succeed by giving them access to Microsoft software development tools, connecting them with key industry players, including investors, and providing marketing visibility to help entrepreneurs starting a business. Ultralight Startups is a BizSpark network partner, which allows Ultralight members streamlined approval to the BizSpark program. If you're built on Microsoft technology or are considering it, you should definitely join BizSpark.
Don't hesitate. Do not hesitate. Join BizSpark immediately through Ultralight Startups. Okay. Amazon Web Services. Amazon built upon the same world-class technology that powers Amazon.com, your favorite e-commerce site. Amazon Web Services provides a reliable, easy-to-scale, low-cost cloud computing offering. Startups and companies of all sizes around the globe use AWS to power a wide variety of web applications, including social gaming, mobile, e-commerce, media and entertainment, life sciences, and much, much more. To learn more and stay in touch, you can go to aws.amazon.com. You can tweet at AWS Startups. And on Ustream, you can see Rodica, who's sitting in Seattle, I believe, right now, but participating actively in the Ustream chat room as AWS Startups in the Ustream chat room. So you can find her there. And Amazon is giving one of the prizes to tonight's pitch contest, which you're all voting in proliferously right now.
Prolifically.
Prolifically.
I like proliferously better, but
I coined a term right here. Here are our local sponsors. So, Datagram, Mike Dietz.
Rise, Mike Dietz.
You can stand, you can sit, you can do whatever you like. Mike Dietz, right here. Datagram is a New York City-based internet service provider with a proven track record hosting major media websites and top blogs such as The Huffington Post. Their services include both dedicated and virtual server hosting, allowing the Ultralight community to have the reliability and support that they need for a reasonable cost with a hosting provider that can help them grow their best expectations and beyond. Datagram recently signed a partnership to provide mobile applications to their customers using Shoutem's mobile application platform. So highly relevant, not only to the Ultralight audience, but to today's event and all the mobile entrepreneurs out there. Mike's right up in front, so you can see him at the break too. Jim Bruni is in the back. Here's Jim Bruni with the red hat. He has put away his Phillies cap for tonight. He's a Mets fan today, or Yankees, as the case may be. Jim Bruni is president of Bruni PR, a leading New York City-based public relations firm that specializes in media relations for technology, internet, financial, and professional services companies. Excuse me. Jim was on our panel in January on startup PR and did a fantastic job there. So if you need PR for your startup, you should check out Jim at the break. Seamless Web, we only have two more to go. Seamless Web, I don't believe is here today, but they're providing the pizza that you will all be enjoying momentarily.
Oh, they're here. Oh, yes.
For those of you who don't know, Seamless Web has provided the pizza that New York attendees will be joining. So if you're in Boston or Toronto or at home,
there's still a solution for you. You can actually order right now with a discount, which I'll get to in a moment. Seamless Web is an online food ordering service that features 4,000 restaurants in 27 cities. You can find and sort through restaurants that deliver to your address and pay a tip by credit card online. For people viewing the video stream from home, you'll see a coupon code for a 10% discount at the bottom of the page on Ultralight TV. So you have to order today, and you get 10% off any order from Seamless Web. So thanks very much to Rich and the pizza tonight. Now, lastly, we have Joe Chin with SourcePad. Joe is a frequent attendee at Ultralight Startups and has been working with me and mentoring me personally now, I have to say, on many things. Serial entrepreneur. SourcePad builds iPhone, Android, and web apps for startups and businesses of all sizes. They have a process that uses video, agile, and developers handpicked based on coding tests to deliver quality development at affordable prices. Their staff has worked with major companies such as Intel, Procter & Gamble, and Adobe, and today work with over 30 Ultralight Startups companies, including The Week, Talamu, and Lucite. So if you want to build an iPhone, Android, or web app, please come and speak to Joe anytime. All right. So I have a couple of my own announcements. The next Ultralight Startups is going to be in 5 weeks from today at our other location, which is Microsoft in Midtown, Thursday, May 12th, on the topic of sales for startups. That's a very important topic, which we've never covered here yet, so I'm very excited to explore that topic with all you in 5 weeks. Anybody here have over 2,000 Twitter followers? TJ does. Well, if you do, or if you're watching from home, you may be interested to know that you can get into this event for free if you do, and you live tweet us. So you basically sit here and you tweet play-by-play of what happens at Ultralight Startups, and that goes out to your 2,000 or more Twitter followers, and that gets you in for free. Or if you have a blog that has 10,000 or more unique visitors on compete.com. The sponsors, we already covered. So I think that's about it. I am now going to announce the winners. Do we have winners for our pitch contest?
Oh, we have winners.
We do. We do have winners. So how are we going to do this?
I am them down here, or do you want me to come running back there? It's more dramatic. Bring it down. Come on. You're the next contestant.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Lindenberger is the master of... Come on down. Come on. He has the answers. It's like the Academy Awards, isn't it? If there are votes right now, then unfortunately those are not going to be counted. It's not as if I didn't give you plenty of time to cast your votes. What happened?
That's never happened.
Do we have a tie?
All right, we have a tie.
A tie.
Yes. For second and third, I'm getting
so there's two second place winners, then, effectively.
So we have two second place winners. There's no third place.
There's no third place.
Everybody is a winner somehow. Yes. So in third, but really second place, is Pixabull. Very nice. Very nice. And equally in third or second place is OGolf. Congratulations. Just goes to show, you bring enough people to pitch and you're going to win something. But our number one winning pitch tonight...
Should we mention the prizes? Just
to build up the suspense,
yes, even
a
more.
Little bit more. Okay.
We know who it is. So the prizes, once again, $200 in Amazon Web Services credit to use on the service of your choice from Amazon Web Services. $300 in media training from TJ Walker and Media Training Worldwide. And then various blog exposure, which I'm sure will be amplified many times. And furthermore, even on top of that, we're going to be interviewing all three of these winners. All three people get all the same prizes. So if you're winning, then you should, A, come up right now. So Andres, come up. And what was the fellow's name from OGolf? Come on up. And one more person who David's going to mention right now.
You ready?
Drum roll.
Here it is. And the winner is Sonar.
Okay.
Good stuff.
So we are going to go to a break. Do we have an interview that's ready to go right now? So if you are watching from home, you can continue to watch either an interview of one of our panelists or one of these three guys. All three of these guys go back up to that corner of the room and do not eat pizza until you get interviewed.
And the rest of you, pizza is already set up outside. You can go enjoy it and talk to one of our sponsors. Oh. Entrepreneurs here tonight would like to some added media exposure. We have a correspondent from The Pitching Well here tonight. That's TJ. TJ Walker is looking to interview any startup who'd like to give a 60-second elevator pitch about their business. Please see him during the break, which is right now.
Right now.
Other than that, okay, continue.
Okay, now you can eat pizza. But go see TJ.
Welcome to Halftime. On our deck, we have Brett Martin from Stonar. And if you guys have been watching it all, you saw the excellent pitches all together. I thought that was a very, very good group.
Yeah, everybody did a great job. It was fun being up there.
Nonetheless, you came out ahead of the pack. How does it feel?
It feels pretty good, but I wouldn't say it was me. It was my team who's back at the office cranking right now. So thanks to Brent, Ajay, Winnie, and all the rest of the great Stern guys, Andre, and Natalie, and Brendan, and all my wonderful interns from Stern. So thanks, everybody.
It's just one of those moments, those Oscar moments, where you're going to like forget someone's name. So you might as well just say everyone.
I forgot Mom and Dad and everybody. Sorry.
Anyway, obviously, there was a lot of it was very popular, your idea. You want to tell us more about that in terms of, you know, were you surprised at the reaction today? Have you pitched before?
This is the first time. I was hoping people would like it, but I haven't really we've been trying to figure it out. The goal is to give people a way to sort of like, as you spend your whole lives like sitting over your computers, filling out your profiles, and you know, we want to give you a way to take your online identity offline and use it to, you know, connect with real people in the real world. We just want more people to meet and make the world a cozier place.
Great. And you've been around for 4 months, so what is your tips for pitching and getting the word out and getting to this point where you're actually like the number one pitch at Ultralight Startups?
Well, we're still in private beta, but if you guys want to check it out, it's sonar.me, and we'd love your help testing out the product and any feedback. I feel like a bobble doll, actually. All I do is kind of just walk around and people hit me on the head and I give the pitch, so I think a lot of practice is all I can recommend. Really.
Well, great. Thanks very much, Brett. Congratulations. And we're going to go ahead and interview the next guest. But thank you. That was awesome.
Pleasure meeting you. And they did great. So thanks
okay,
a lot.
Thank you. And thank you to your team. Okay, up next, we've got Dan.
All right. Thank you, Jennifer. Coming up, we have Matthew Snyder from ADO Strategies. He's talking to a lot of people. It's very busy right here. Everybody's excited to meet him. Oh, there you go. Again, this is Matthew Snyder from ADO Strategies. How are you tonight, sir?
Good.
Good. How are you? It's actually AD Objects. Analog Digital Objects is the company, and we have a consultancy, strategic consultancy called ADO Strategies. We have a full-service agency, ADO Cross Media, and we also do investing. We have a small angel investing part.
And as I was researching, it's very odd that you actually graduated from the same high school and same college that Graham went to. Is this information that you knew?
I didn't know it until he told me. You know, it's you would figure that we'd somehow be able to get information on the web with people that you'd know that, but I didn't know it until he mentioned it. So he must have noticed some of my friends on Facebook and then kind of drew that coincidence. But it's kind of odd.
Well, it would be interesting now that we saw that Sonar app. I think out of all of them, that was the winner tonight. But it'd be interesting to see the Sonar to see if there are any connections. Well, I guess that Facebook, we could do that with like mutual friends. But how did you get into the mobile startup app game?
Well, I run a full service agency called ADO Cross Media, and so I am working with a lot of brands and marketers, and I am working, I am building out different apps for some companies, particularly interested in the AR space, augmented reality, and then I'm also working with brands on some of their apps. But I've been a very big believer of a web strategy first over an app strategy for a variety of reasons, and so I was asked because I can give a good holistic picture of mobile strategies. I've actually been in mobile since 95 and actually worked on some of the earliest apps in the late 90s. I worked for Nokia. I was a director of strategy there until 07, and have been involved for a variety of different areas from in mobile.
And do you think the whole, with Android coming out, do you think that's going to change, or is that definitely putting Apple on the defense for your clients?
Well, it's just right now what I find is my clients are in Canada and the U.S., and most of them, we just go straight with iPhone first. But what I did, I just did something last week for Fashion Week, and I was surprised that all of the audience was on BlackBerry. And it was quite unique, and even though I have a lot of stats in Canada that prove that most of the internet browsing is on iPhone, the surprising numbers were on BlackBerry. And we actually did something very unique with Fashion Week, with QR codes, and an integrated shop. And surprisingly, even though all these services were available to users on BlackBerry, they have a device. It's like they're driving a sports car and they don't know how to use the engine. So we actually spent a lot of time training people, and it was very educational. But it's interesting to see how all the device manufacturers really come into play now in this next wave. We'll see how Microsoft with Win. And then also Android is just getting extremely powerful, but it's fragmented. So it just makes it very difficult. And I think in the app world, you know, we called it compatibility hell or just it's a challenge when you have all these different apps, all these different platforms. And as companies start to compete, it's going to get even more difficult as you have to start releasing for all the different platforms. And so we're just at the beginning of this. And so, you know, as they battle it out, it just makes it difficult for the developer. And so I say stick with the iPhone first, and then as you see your market and you can really define it, then you can scale across the others.
Well, I'll follow up on the iPhone, but the QR codes, I mean, we're definitely starting to see them. Like, I produce a comedy show, and it's definitely things I'm implementing, like, just very subversive. Do you use it more for like metrics, or people are actually using them? Like, what is your, are you yay or nay for QR codes?
So I'm kind of mixed on them. I think that they're kind of an icon to identify. It's like a marketing tactic for mobile. I've been in mobile for a long time. I watched QR codes rise in Japan, and when you put it on a poster, it just makes you aware, a user aware. It's almost like a branding for mobile. The real usage is questionable. And I had a good meeting today with a company that said, why not just take a picture of the poster and just use that as a you could recognize the poster. It's unique in its own right. And so, you know, picture recognition has become very sophisticated. So having a QR code on media affects the brand. But I think at this point in the evolution of where things are going, it's a very good icon for mobile. And so I think that, you know, users will use it, it'll be consistent, but it's, I don't see it, even in my own mind, that it's going to be something that 80% of the market's going to use, like an email. Mm-hmm. I think it's and what really got me by surprise is Microsoft has now their own. And so in many ways, the QR codes and barcodes are fragmenting. And so things like Red Laser, I like, that kind of pull them together and just have even leverage the 2D barcode, but as an application. And they do have an API, and you can integrate Red Laser into a variety of apps. Red Laser did quite a bit at South by Southwest, which was impressive this year.
Well, that's incredible. That's exactly the information I need to know, and we're going to learn more information when we do the panelists, but we really want to thank you for coming out. Again, this is Matt Schneider. We're going to see him later on, but thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're going to bring up David Carlos and another panelist. And I guess he's learning more information.
All right, and here we are with Nihal Mehta. Did I pronounce that right?
You did.
Yeah. All right, and Nihal has a very interesting new thing. He used to do Buzzed. It says Buzzed on his shirt here in small letters, but in big letters, there it is, Local Response. So, Nihal, tell us about Local Response.
Yep, so Local Response is a very simple platform allowing businesses and brands to respond to check-ins. I put check-ins in quotes because it's not just a Foursquare check-in or a Gowalla check-in. Could also be a mobile photo or just natural language on Twitter and Facebook. So what that means is if you can say you're at Whole Foods on Twitter, mm-hmm. we can help Kraft Foods send you a coupon. If you say, are you checking to a gym, we can help Coca-Cola send you free Powerade. Actually, in 10 days, we're launching a self-service platform for local businesses. So if you are Shake Shack, you can type in Shake Shack at localresponse.com. We'll show you all of your customers. We'll actually suggest some of them that you should reach out to, suggest a message you might want to send. With two clicks, you can create a campaign to drive those customers back into your doors.
So this is all business to business. This is, you're not doing any B2C with this.
Correct. Yeah, Buzzed was a B2C. This is a pivot for the B2B space.
Okay. And you're also involved with a venture firm. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so I've been in the mobile space for a long time, 12 years, a little bit too long probably. So technically this is my fourth startup. Along the way, just made some investments in some friends' companies. My first investment was a small company called AdMob, which was great. And so we formalized sort of the investment strategy into a fund called ENIAC. And so ENIAC has today about 19 investments. ENIAC is named after the world's first computer.
I was going to ask if there was a relationship there.
Of course. The world's first computer now has less computing power than or a phone probably has 100x the computing power of the ENIAC that took up a whole room. So it's fun. It's more of a hobby. But I have three great partners, and we're doing about an investment a month. And we feel like being entrepreneurs really helps us because we not only can identify interesting companies on the ground, but we can really help and empower entrepreneurs with things that we learn in our daily lives.
Now, what has your involvement with Ultralight Startups been? How did you get involved first? I know you've been on a panel in the past. You're going to be a panelist tonight.
Yep.
Where did that come from?
Yeah, I think Graham reached out last year and had a great panel and was very successful. I feel like just speaking about mobile, just being in the space for so long, I can contribute a lot. So I love these atmospheres that are targeted and I have a lot of energy. This Ultralight in particular, really impressed with the size and the breadth and the diversity of the people here. So you guys have done a great job and look forward to the panel. Look forward to coming back.
Yeah, absolutely. So if you're out there, make sure you stay out there because you're going to see this guy a bunch, as well as a bunch of other guys who know a lot more than I do about anything mobile up there on our panel. So stay tuned. We're going to interview a couple more people. But Nihal, thank you so much. Local Response, there it is. Know it, learn it, love it, tweet it,
do everything to it as long as it's legal. All right. Thanks. All right. But I think we have some of our panel winners. Yes, we do. We have who do we have? Ray, you're going to do Shanif? Oh, nice. All right, so I'm going to give you over to Ray. He's going to give you to Sharif, to Shanif. Shanif, and we'll have some more fun. Here you go.
Thank you very much, David. Hi, Ray Bernays here again. I'm here with Shanif Dinani from OGolf. So Shanif, I know you're you pitched here today. I think tied for second place. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I think a very timely application. It's a golf application that, as it's warming up and people are getting outside, I think something they can use. And as I understand, it's something that's available. So can you just give us a quick recap of what OGolf is and what the application does?
Sure, definitely. OGolf is essentially a handheld GPS caddy. So what it does is, when you're out on the golf course, it basically lets you find how far you are from your current position to any point on the course, the hole, sand traps, things of that nature. It also lets you keep track of score, and it keeps track of how far you hit the ball.
Now, there are a couple unique things about the application that you highlighted in the pitch. Could you want to touch on a couple of those?
Absolutely. One of our big features is that we actually have images for all of the golf courses in the U.S. So what we can do is let you download those images straight to your phone, so you don't need to use internet out on the golf course. What this lets you do is it lets you play more smoothly, and it gives you a very accurate GPS measurement.
Very good. Now, I know you you mentioned to me that you're a student here at NYU, and it seemed like you were here with your team of co-founders or developers. Do you want to tell us a little about the team and how you guys came together?
Sure, absolutely. First thing I have to say, I have a great team. I've had so much fun working with these guys, all very smart. We are all actually MBA ones at NYU Stern School of Business. What we do is most of us come from a technical background. I have a computer science background. We also have telecommunications engineers, lawyers, computer engineers. So we are a very strong team, and we're very well-rounded. We all met each other at Stern. We were all in our first year. And we all have an interest in entrepreneurship. And when we started talking, we all just came together.
So why golf?
So that's a great question. Our CEO and co-founder is actually an avid golfer. He plays maybe 10 to 20 rounds per year. And he's tried all of our competition products. And he just thinks that they don't cut it. And as he played more and more, he just realized that there's a market out there that he can tap into. And there's a big business opportunity.
Excellent. Do you yourself golf?
That's a great question. I get that every time that I talk about this product. Unfortunately, I've only been to a driving range twice. So I do not golf myself. We do have two avid golfers on the team. Those guys kind of ground us in what it takes to make it a successful product.
I'm guessing you're probably going to be signed up for some lessons this summer.
Absolutely. Be a golfer soon enough.
Absolutely. Now what's on tap for the next release of the application? What are you guys working on now?
Okay. I'm glad you asked that. Right now, because we have downloadable images, we need to coordinate the images with GPS data. So what we're going to do is build out our golf course database. We only have a handful of playable databases right now. That's going to grow over the course of the next 3 months. Once we have the entire U.S. playable, we're going to go to different regions in the country and partner with the golf courses there to help them help us sell the product.
Excellent. Sounds exciting. I think just kind of in closing, what's the call to action for the people out there? I know you mentioned the application's out there and available. What should people do next?
Okay, for all of the golfers out there, we ask you, go download the application. It's available for free right now, and we have the handful of courses that are available, so you can get our courses before we start charging for them. Go download it, provide us feedback, pretty constructive feedback that we can use to improve our application, and just let us know what you think. If you want to check out our website, it's ogolf.me, M-E.
Thank you very much, Shanif. Good luck with everything. Congratulations on winning today.
Thank you very much.
Well done. Well done. So I think up next, we have Andre from Pixable. We'll need to go grab him from his networking, and we'll bring him up.
Hopes are a lie that you tore. Left you with nothing.
right, Ray Bernays here again, this time with Andres from Pixabl. Andres, you tied for second place in the pitch contest. Congratulations. Can you tell us a bit about Pixabl and the product you have? Just a real quick two-sentence summary.
Yeah, sure. So Pixabl is a place that grabs all your photos from all the different social networks and standardizes all the data and ranks it so you can discover the best content out there without having to look at constantly your Facebook newsfeed or go to Flickr and look at all the photos or then go to Instagram. It's the best content out there.
Excellent, excellent. Now, I know you've been with Ultralight Startups for, you know, I think it was about 18 months ago that you last presented. Yeah. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what's changed from when you presented back then till now?
Definitely. So a lot has changed. Like, our vision has always been around aggregating photos. So when we started this, the whole idea was around grabbing photos from Facebook, Flickr, Picasa, and all these other websites and creating products with them, like photo books, calendars, posters. There was actually nobody doing this at that stage, and it was a very exciting business model. We saw great growth. But there were a few things that we really wanted to tackle that were very interesting. The first one is that we were tied to a certain demographic. It was moms between 35 and older. And at the same time, these moms would come 3 to 5 times a year to actually create a product. But what we realized when we were looking at users using our site is that when they were selecting the photos to actually do an album, they were discovering a lot of content. They were like, wow, most of these photos I've never seen. And then you hear the typical, wow, I can't believe that this woman is pregnant, or I can't believe that this guy moved to New York. So we're like, wow, this is very interesting. And then we started thinking, like, what is the percentage of people that want to see photos? And it's 100%. And then we said, like, how many times a year would they want to do? Because now it's 3 to 5 times a year using our product, and it's like every day. So we got really excited about this problem, and we really wanted to solve it. And it started as a pet project, and it became our north very recently. We released the app 2.5 months ago, and it has already over 300,000 users. So we know that there's a great opportunity out there, and that's why we're going to get it.
That's great growth. Congratulations. I mean, I think one thing that is interesting to me, right, is you look at how the consumption of photos is really relying on having a good screen, something that you can view, and given how the hardware has changed over time, I'm sure that's contributing to it. How has the constant stream of new phones, new devices like the iPad and other tablets affected the way that users use your product?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I think the iPad is a great example of something that has really made our product just stronger, because looking photos on the iPad is the most beautiful way you can consume it. It's even more beautiful than even just printing and having it. It's so dynamic, and because you can touch it and swipe it, it just gives you a great feel. And the proliferation of iPads has been great for us. We released an iPad app, and it has great traction. And what has happened with mobile photos that has made our opportunity even bigger is that people now have a great mobile camera in their pocket 24/7. And this makes the problem just so much bigger. Like, last year, Facebook was averaging 2 to 3 billion photos a month. Now we're talking about 5 to 6 billion photos a month. And this is all because of mobile photos. So they're making our problem bigger, so it's even a better opportunity for us to solve.
That's a good problem to have. Now, one last question for you before we move to the next guest. What's next? What's on the development roadmap?
So pretty much what's next now is, first is a consolidation of all of your social graphs. The idea is that now you can connect to Facebook and we rank your friends and we pull the best photos. We're going to do the same thing with all the other social graphs. And then we're looking towards more about interest. So, like, the idea is that you want to see photos of your friends on a daily basis. That's something that you really enjoy. But at the same time, you want to see photos of other interests that you have. So let's say that you're a fan of Coldplay. Like, if you like Coldplay as a band, we can pull live photos of them, and you can actually have a channel of them, and you can get live photos. And this happens not only with bands or celebrities, this is also by interest. Like, the tsunami in Japan this month, like, that's a topic of great interest. Why can't you have a photo feed that can actually just show you all those photos? So this is pretty much what we're looking for now.
Excellent. Well, good luck with that. And again, congratulations and great product. So thank you, Andres. So up next, we have Jennifer, I think, who has TJ Walker on. So here you go.
Thank you very much, Ray. Okay, we have a special guest today. We have TJ Walker, who is going to talk to you about the services that he provides, not only just to ultralight startups, but he also deals with a lot of Fortune 500 companies. These skills are very necessary for entrepreneurs. So TJ, why don't you tell us more about what you do?
Well, the number one skill an entrepreneur has to do is talk to people, talk to investors, talk to your mother for more money, talk to people about becoming co-founders. You have to communicate effectively. And that's what we do at Media Training Worldwide. We help you come across comfortable, confident, relaxed, to shape your message, to package your message with stories. The number one problem most entrepreneurs have is they're too abstract. They're lost in the clouds, and people can't really remember it. Therefore, they can't tell other people. If you've got a successful case study with a customer, tell people about it. Tell them by name. Don't just say we service applications in the such and such market. Be really specific and concrete. So that's what we help people do. And as a special bonus to any of the Ultralight fans out there, I will give you a free copy of my book, Media Training A to Z, the PDF version. All you have to do is email me, and they can send an email to tj@tjwalker.com. And I'll actually give you a free copy of two of my books, Media Training A to Z and my Secret to Foolproof Presentations.
So tell us about some success stories of people who have used your services and something miraculous has happened.
Well, one of my clients got elected president of Panama. One of my clients became Miss Universe. So I work with people in all sorts of industries. The number one, the only thing that's remarkably consistent among wildly successful people, it's not necessarily that they get up early or their diet or their religious beliefs. It's they know how to communicate effectively. That's the one thing that's common among great leaders, not just in business, but politics, any industry.
And how do entrepreneurs, do you teach entrepreneurs about the elevator pitch?
Yes.
It's a big market.
Well, it's not a big market for me, but it's a way of sort of giving back to the business community and planting seeds for future growth.
So if somebody was interested in hiring you, how would they get in touch with you?
Well, they can just contact me directly. Go to tj@tjwalker.com. The best way to get started is let me give you something of value. And as I mentioned, giving away a couple of books, all they have to do is email me.
And your website?
Mention Ultralight. The website is mediatrainingworldwide.com. 3Ws.mediatrainingworldwide.com.
Now, we know you're used to working with a lot of bigger companies who have much more money than entrepreneurs. So what sort of price points do you offer people that are startups?
Well, we have online training for as low as $295. We have PDFs for $9. And if you're a big company and you need a lot of work, there's six-figure packages. So we have something for everyone.
And what is the biggest tip that you want to share right now with entrepreneurs?
The number one tip is if you're nervous about speaking, first of all, you should be. Chances are you're not very good. Practice on video and watch yourself. If you don't like how you come across, there's probably a good reason. Keep practicing till you like what you see on the video.
So there you go. We're going to end it there.
That's why you're good. You've seen yourself on video.
I don't know about that, but we'll just move it forward. Graham's about to start. This is going to be the mobile app startup. So very exciting panel.
Thanks.
Thank you, TJ.
Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Allegiance, get your boutiques on, all black everything, black cards, black cars, all black everything, and our girls are black birds, riding with they diligence, I get more in depth if you boys really real enough, this is not familiar, I'll explain later, but for now let me get back to this paper, I'm a couple bands down and I'm trying to get back, I gave Doug a grip, I lost a flip for 5 stacks. I'm talking 5,60, got zeros, hit up. Back to running circles round, niggas, now we squared up. Hold up.
Life's a game, but it's not fair. Yeah. I break the rules, so I don't care. Uh-huh. So I keep doing my own thing. Walking tall against the rain. Victories within the mile. Almost there, don't give a foul. Only thing that's on my mind is who gonna run this town tonight.
Yeah.
turn up the guard, peace guard. Ain't nobody fresher, I'm in Mason. Martin Martella on the table screaming, fuck the other side, they jealous. We got a banquet full of bras, they got a table full of fellas. Yeah. And they ain't spending no cake, they should throw their hand in, cause they ain't got no space. Yeah. My whole team got dough, so my banquet is looking like millionaires, bro.
Life's a game, but it's not fair. I break the rules, so I don't care. So I keep doing my own thing. Walking tall.
Okay. So I neglected to make a couple of announcements before the break, so I'm going to do so right now. Does this mic seem very low? Can you guys hear me? Yeah? Okay. So Aaron Sylvan, is Aaron around? Aaron is right here. Okay. So Aaron is our dedicated Ultralight Startups photographer. LemonadeHeroes.com is a site for entrepreneurs to share their stories and personal challenges. Aaron Sylvan, Ultralight Startups' dedicated photographer, is funding the project through the sale of portrait photography. If you stop Aaron when he's walking around with a camera, he'll send you a free portrait for social media. And for high-res photos, he's offering a 20% discount to Ultralight Startups members. With the discount, high-res portraits start at only $80, so contact him directly or sign up at lemonadeheroes.com. And for all of you on the panel and everyone that's pitching tonight, you may get, if you haven't already, a Facebook friend request from me, which will then allow me to tag the photo that Aaron took of you tonight while speaking or pitching. So if you want to be tagged, then be sure and be my friend. And what else do we have? I'm going to make a pitch for Ultralight Startup sponsors. Ultralight Startups events are attended in person and viewed online by thousands of online business owners each month. If you'd like to become a sponsor in New York or Boston or Toronto or everywhere at once, find me or your local chapter organizer, which would be Nick in Toronto or Chris in Boston, and we will set you up. Startups. That's my new venture that I'm starting.
Just in case you care.
Very stealthy. Yeah, that's a good. Thank you very much for that. Spelling has never been my strong suit. So we're here today to talk about mobile app startups and specifically how to make money with mobile apps. And we have an esteemed panel here that is going to tell us how to do that, because they're all experienced and have done it before, either for their own companies, companies they're invested in, and or their clients. So I'm going to introduce the panel briefly and then have them each talk about their projects, and then we're going to get into the content, which is monetizing and developing and marketing mobile apps. So first we have Nihal Mehta. He's the co-founder and CEO at Buzzed, and also Local Response, which he may be mentioning in a moment. And he's a general partner at ENIAC Ventures, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, which is a seed stage venture fund focused exclusively on the mobile software sector. So it's a mobile app venture fund. So that's Nihal. Dan Mellinger is the co-founder and CEO at Socialite, which is a content and community management system, API, and suite of mobile application frameworks for the capture, organization, search, social consumption, and distribution of local-based content. And he also happens to be the founder and organizer of Mobile Monday New York, which is a community of people much like yourselves interested in mobile apps. Greg Rice, am I pronouncing that right? Rice. Greg Rice is the founder and CEO at Rice Labs, which is a premier application design and development agency based in Boston. So for those of you who are in Boston, he's come all the way down here to New York for this. Clients include Runkeeper, Benjamin Moore, and MIT, amongst others. So welcome, Greg. And lastly, Matthew Snyder. Matthew is the founder and CEO at ADO Strategies, which is a mobile strategy and business development consulting services firm. And he works extensively in New York City, as well as Vancouver and Tokyo. Is that right, Matthew?
Yep.
Okay. And he coincidentally also happened to go to both the same high school and the same college as me.
Glenbrook North High School, for those of you in the Chicago suburbs.
And I'm also running an event series called Media by Media, kind of turn New York City into the take South by Southwest and move it to New York City.
Really?
But it's Media Cross Media. We did our first event in October. It's all about mobile convergence with media, and was very successful, and we're going to be doing a lot more. So stay tuned to hear about Media by Media, Media Cross Media.
Okay. So now we're going to let each of these guys talk a little bit about their own current projects. So like maybe 1 minute or so. Nihal, you can choose any one of your ventures. Maybe you're going to give us an exclusive here and talk about local response.
Can we talk about the spelling mistake again? Sorry. tough crowd. So Buzzed, for those of you that might be familiar with it, was a mobile app started a few years ago. We aggregated real-time social media feeds on Facebook, Foursquare, Twitter, Looped, Whirl, Gowalla, Instagram, Path, Color, the list goes on and on. Local response is actually a pivot from Buzzed, where we're actually allowing businesses and brands to respond to all these various check-ins across all these various services. So for example, if you say that you're at Crunch Fitness or you check in on Foursquare to Crunch Fitness, you might find Coca-Cola sending you a free Powerade, right, across all these aggregated sort of location check-ins or public postings of locations. So that's local response. We're actually launching in under 2 weeks, so look out for it. We have these really hot t-shirts, thanks to Sprung over there, and I'll be demoing our local business self-serve interface, which we think is pretty cool. But that's kind of the project I'm most interested about right now.
Okay, thanks, Nihal. I'll mention that we've only done a mobile panel here once before. Nihal was on that as well. He's the only one of these three that was. When I was recruiting this panel, I had a very particular profile in mind, and it was a founder and CEO of multiple mobile startups. I would say like 50% of the people that recommended panelists to me recommended Nihal. So he's the essential person in mobile startups in New York City. So
that's what happens when you ask my parents.
Awesome. So Dan, you want to talk about Socialite?
Sure, Graham. So I am founder and CEO of Socialite. A little bit on myself. I have been in mobile for like over 10 years now. I started out in B2B, doing enterprise apps for the big banks back in like the early 2000s. And founded Socialite in 2005. We are a cloud-based platform for building your own local social applications. So a lot of those become local curated guides to various places and for various types of people. So be it art lovers, sushi lovers, or people visiting the town of San Diego, you can find an application for that, and we make it really easy. You can get up and running in just about 30 minutes. You could have an app and custom design it using our website, and then deploy it and produce it out to multiple app platforms. And if you're a developer, you can use our API to build whatever you want on top of it. So we have about 1,000 of those now. I'm also, as Graham said, co-founder of Mobile Monday, New York. So I'll give a little plug for that. It's a group. We have over 3,000 mobile professionals in New York City. It's part of Mobile Monday International, which has over 100 chapters around the world. So if you're not in New York, look up your local chapter. And we do events about monthly. Our next one is coming up later this month. Go to mobilemonday-ny.com to check it out. And that's about it. It's like to be here.
Great. Thanks, Dan. And Greg, talk about Raise Labs.
Sure. My name is Greg Raise, and I'm a founder and CEO of a company called Raise Labs. We're a Boston-based company. We help other companies, both startups and established companies, figure out mobile and what that means to their business and their product. And so we work with them on three things. We help them figure out strategy and kind of where they should be going in mobile, both short-term and long-term. We help them design those products, and we focus on user experience and making those interactions with the device simple, intuitive, and friendly. And then we help them build those products. So we do a lot of development in taking those ideas from concept and then taking them all the way through delivery in the App Store. I'm also the founder of a group in Boston for people listening in from Boston. It's a kind of social group called Drinks on Tap, and we meet up at a bar and we give cool demos of iPhone apps. So a lot of cool stuff happening in mobile, and we're trying to be a part of it.
Awesome. Thanks very much, Greg. Thanks for coming down. So Matthew,
Yes, so I've actually been in mobile since 95. I helped Nokia establish in Japan and launched their first program and have been involved with apps.
What are you working on right now?
Since the first apps. And I run a company called ADO, which is a full-service mobile agency focused on marketing. And then also we have the strategy side, ADO Strategies, and ADO Design, which is a small incubator. We actually have two startups we're bringing out quite soon. But through ADO Strategies, we work with everyone from a small startup, working on a company called Wantlet, which is the Twitter of wants, to big companies like Microsoft with Bing, help them launch search.
Okay. Wonderful. Thanks so much, Matthew. So the question to start with is, how do you make money with mobile apps? And let's look at who is making money right now. So we're looking at this first slide. I spoke with each of you on the phone beforehand, and you gave me the companies that are mentioned in mostly in parentheses here. So who's making money with premium apps? Nahal, why don't you start with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think they say 80% of mobile app usage is specifically for iOS are mobile games, and the chief revenue model for mobile games is a premium model, and so services like Angry Birds, for example, or specifically services that encourage in-app purchases. So Android just launched in-app purchases recently, I think a couple weeks ago. And that's a huge revenue driver for any of these games, much like the analogy of for Zynga, you know, online with Farmville. It's starting to take off in a big way on mobile. So I would say the vast majority of revenue created right now in the app world is based on subscriptions, you know, in and out of games, but I'm sure other folks have opinions as well.
Okay. And we just got a note from Boston that we need to speak directly into the mics if you're on the panel. I think Nahal just did a fantastic job, so if you can do that, then you're in good shape. So who else? So somebody talked about enterprise apps that were making money. Greg, was that you?
Yeah, I mean, there's kind of different ways to think about making money in the app store. And so, you know, across this list, you definitely see, you know, premium apps that you buy for a dollar, a couple dollars. And, you know, if you look at the top of the charts of the app store, predominantly you see a lot of games and entertainment titles. You know, there's obviously a lot of other types of productivity tools. So you'll see utilities and fitness apps and other things like that, you know, that will sell for a couple dollars. You know, these are apps that can generate, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars, you know, in some cases millions of dollars, but sort of at the top of the funnel, you know, generating tens of millions of dollars, we do see a lot of entertainment and kind of in-app purchase. We're seeing a lot of other applications generating business models that sort of combine the web and mobile. And so you're seeing a lot of these larger content companies figuring out how to work both sides of the table. We're also seeing a lot of apps that monetize through subscription. So either, you know, software as a service with the app as a medium or a channel for bringing that experience into mobile.
Okay. And utilities, who's it? Matthew, you were talking about utilities, Evernote, making money?
Yeah.
Anything else? And speak into the mic.
So in terms of utilities, there's quite a lot out there.
That makes money with premium app sales.
And so I've been a big believer in the freemium model. How do you when you build an app, to make sure you also have a paid model around it. You know, look at Angry Birds. I mean, they do about $1 million a month in revenue for their free app, and then over $100 million in their paid. And so that balance, I think if you do build an app, you have to look at both models. And Nihal did highlight, I think, a very strong area, which is going to keep growing, is the in-app payments. But right now, being able to really leverage both, I think, is critical. It's tough because users want things free, but then that 99 cents, I call it like a digital dessert. We don't mind spending you know, a couple dollars for a piece of cake. If someone likes something and they're emotionally attached to it, they're definitely going to pay for it. So I really believe on that balance. And so the utility apps, you know, that's really the, you know, the stickiness. We want to go back to it every day. But I think the key with an app over something like the mobile web is really that entertainment value. And so I'm working with a group in Canada that actually wants to build an Evernote for artists. When they're on their tour, they constantly have their receipts, but they don't know how to deal with billing it. And then we've been talking about how do you create that entertainment value. So the app itself really gives all of the opportunities with the APIs to really do something that has an entertainment value to it. So, critical.
Cool. And content sales. So this is basically selling not the application, but the content that the application uses. Let's go through some examples of who's making money right now doing this stuff. News based sites.
Yeah, go ahead. I would say, you know, one of the ones that I think is currently being most successful at this is currently Netflix. You know, they really have figured out how to take, you know, what they have as content, which are videos, and bring that into multiple different channels, not just iPhone, iPad, and Android, but into all sorts of other things as well. So they're seeing these as, you know, endpoints for viewership. And so they're trying to be in all these places. And so as far as content and subscription, they're doing a really, really amazing job at delivering their content into multiple channels. We're seeing lots of other sort of magazines trying to figure out, hey, how do I take my content and bring it onto the iPad? We're seeing products like The Daily trying to create new content specifically for the iPad. But they're nowhere near the scale of what I think Netflix is doing across bringing their content to multiple platforms.
Yeah, and on the content subscription side, I think you're seeing is also, if anything, it hasn't been figured out yet. It's almost going down in a way. Another thing that we should bring up, though, like a lot of what we're talking about is focused on consumers paying directly for applications. I mean, enterprise has been brought up a bit, but mobile is just another way of accessing content, experiences, services, other than, you know, any other way we do it, or PC, or whether it's person to person or anything. So the mobile ecosystem and ways to make money, if we're talking here as, like, you know, potential startups, I should look at ourselves who are making money not by selling the apps. We have a few paid apps, but the vast majority of them are free. We're providing services for others that are making money in another way. And, you know, is the hit-driven business in games. I mean, I took a look at, to echo what Nihal said, at some pretty good statistics. 9 out of 10 top grossing apps in the App Store are games, 3 of which are Angry Bird variants. and then the last one.
And Groupon clones.
Yeah, right. But yeah, I think thinking outside the box about revenue models and how mobile can be used and leveraged toward existing things that consumers do and enterprises need is another very important revenue stream now and in the future.
Okay. What about in-app purchases? This seems to be like what's replacing premium apps. People are saying get the app for free and then use the app to buy something, some content, shall we say, that the app uses. So who's making money doing that?
I paid for an app a couple of weeks ago, Runkeeper. So that was one of the first apps that I really enjoyed.
They recently made it free, but they're an interesting company.
Sure.
they actually... They started with a free paid model where they had a free application and a pro application that was $10. And they've since moved a lot of their business to the web where you can actually sign up for subscription services on their web, and the application itself is actually free. So there's a lot, I mean, in-app, you know, to kind of go back to your main thing about in-app purchase, you know, we are seeing some in-app purchase, but, you know, just recently there was a really interesting blog post by a company called TapTapTap that has one of the top grossing applications in the App Store. It's a photo camera application called Camera Plus.
That was the 1 out of 10.
Yeah.
That was not a game.
And they released some of their in-app purchase numbers, which is actually kind of rare. Not a lot of developers do this. And they really talked about how the in-app purchase for selling they had some filters that they released in the app, was pretty much fractional to the overall sales of the app. They made about, I think they said $2 to $3 million on the app itself, and then the in-app purchase amount of additional revenue was in the 60-70K range. So, you know, there are other companies, and I think Zynga and Farmville and these types of companies that have these sort of mining mechanics where in-app purchase is really the core piece of the application make a lot more. But the key piece of advice that I give to companies and startups trying to figure out the App Store and how to make money is to really not think about how do I make money from the app. It's to really figure out the business. You know, what business are you in? You know, when Bank of America goes to make an app, they're not thinking, gee, how can we monetize this app for 99 cents? They're thinking about, you know, how do we enable our customers to interact with our company and do the things that we want to do? And so, you know, that's a very different business model and mentality than if you're writing, you know, a utility that's you're hoping to monetize for 99 cents. You can make money that way, but it's hard to turn that into a huge business. Whereas if you think about your company or your startup as, how do I create and establish a real business, you know, and then have the app be part of that channel, I think you have a much, much bigger trajectory and much, much more upside.
So is that fundamentally different than websites? I mean, I can make a website and my business is a web business, but you're saying you can't do the same for mobile.
Well, I think, again, web is a channel. You know, I think back to maybe, you know, the 90s when you had a brick and mortar store and the web came along and everyone said, you're going to buy everything on the web. And, you know, all these retail channels are going to disappear. Now, some of that has happened, but you've seen that existing retailers, like The Gap as an example, have embraced the web, you know, during the web generation and figured out, here's how we're going to play in the web, and the web is going to be a channel for us. And when mobile came around, they said, we're going to figure out how to play in mobile and have that be an additional channel for us as well. And so, yeah, you can certainly make money on the web, and you can certainly make money on mobile, but it's part of a larger business. So, you know, for them, their business is retailing and how we're going to sell fashion and trends and clothes and hipness. You know, for Bank of America, it's, you know, how do we sell personal finance and, you know, that management. And then the tool, you know, whether it be mobile or whether it be web or whether it's the next thing that comes, you know, three years, 5 years down the road, you know, they're still in the core business that they're in. And so, you know, startups and entrepreneurs should be thinking, what business am I in, and how can I grow that business, and where can I really take advantage of the uniqueness of mobile?
Absolutely. Yeah, question. How do you figure out what your revenue model should be? Whether it should be for free or not. And I urge you to use one of my favorite slides here, how to ask a question at ultralight startups. So, not that you did a terrible job, but 10 to 20 questions ending in a question mark. The reason is because anybody that's viewing us in Boston or Toronto or online can't hear you, and it just sounds like blank space for however long you're talking. So if you keep a question short, and then I'll repeat it, and then we'll go from there. So the question was, you're trying to figure out how to monetize, whether it should be freemium or paid to begin with. Gaming in particular.
Sure. Yeah, so the way I understood the question is, you know, let's say you have a great idea for a game. You know, how do you turn that into a business, or what is that? And so I think gaming is great. You know, you should be thinking of your game as an entertainment company. And so this is something that was, you know, I heard the CEO of Angry Birds speak, and he really kind of highlighted that even in the early development of Angry Birds, they were thinking about how to create a brand and how to create something that could be much more than just a game. And so you should be thinking as well, okay, I'm gonna create a brand, I'm gonna create an entertainment company, and the extension of that may be XYZ. In terms of how to price it, you know, you can look at your competitors, you can look at some of the other things that are going on in the gaming space. I mean, I think the model of how to price things, there are lots of examples of like 99-cent games or in-app purchase games or other stuff. And there are successful examples of all of them. The key takeaway, I think, is really how do you think about yourself as that entertainment company, and what does that mean, and how does that change the way you think about your game or your sequence of games, so that there's a theme or there's a trend, or, you know, how are you figuring out that path for yourself?
An interesting fact, though, that Angry Birds, the guys over, they made 151 before they got it right. So Angry Birds is 152. So I think that there's...
They made 150 what?
151 games before they hit it. So the point is that it's not something that just it happens. And so what really is that the ability to release things very quickly is something I'm seeing with a lot of the Asian app developers, especially in Japan. They're actually building apps and releasing them, new games, new things, once a week until they hit it. And then when they hit it, it's kind of these kind of spikes, and then they grow off of that. So they don't put so much effort in sitting back and thinking. So there's also the marketing paradigm of how do you best figure out who you're actually going to target and the marketing of all of this.
How can you build a useful app in a week?
I mean, these guys are doing very useful apps within a week. I saw one, I mean, they're using a lot of components and things from a lot. It's kind of maybe a cultural thing, but there's Zen Artist, which is a phenomenal app with paintbrushes, and it's actually an AR app. These guys did it in a couple weeks. Really high speed, high turnaround, and that's where I think, you know, these Socialite and platforms out there, is Mother Apps, PhoneGap, platforms, developer platforms that help you actually find that and then evolve, is a lot what they're starting to do as well. So I think that, you know, right now we're looking at how many apps have been downloaded, and we say there's going to be 50 billion, you know, in the next couple of years. It just, there's more and more and more, and on my iPhone screen I only see 10, I see the next 25. It's hard to discover them. And so I'm a big believer in the web as another key to this, as kind of the way that you can actually reach customers through Google search, through Twitter, through Facebook, that links to your app where people can download it very quickly. So, yeah, this is just my thoughts.
I would agree with part of that, but I would disagree with another part. I think it's right that you should iterate, and you should release often and release a little bit early, but I think it's really hard to release anything of sufficient quality in a really short amount of time. And so having enough time to bake and really think and understand your user base is important as well.
I have a quick anecdote. There's a little kid in Utah who built a game called Bubble Ball. I don't know if you guys played this, but they actually trumped Angry Birds for a couple weeks, which is really cool. And this kid's like 14 years old. And I tried to go over to Salt Lake and give him money to invest, but I couldn't find him. you know, there are a lot of tools out there. It's true. The iOS SDK is well documented, you got to just keep on trying, throwing out ideas out there. This was his first game that he created. He's already made something like $25 million on it, but rich little brat.
So on the other side of the coin, I think there's a very strong, you mentioned the utility side of it. I really see the value in loyalty. And so the guys from Mobisted, I think pronounced, you know, this hotel, I wanted to ask the question about how the integration happens with Starwood and all of your loyalty points. And this becomes it replaces your relationship. And so I think that side of it, it does take a lot. And there's the whole enterprise side of it. But in the entertainment space, I think that Rapid, I mean, it's a lesson from the Angry Birds guys.
Okay. So let's talk about advertising. Who's making money in mobile advertising, if anybody?
Yeah, you know, mobile advertising, Graham, you know, that's my background. I've been doing mobile advertising for way too long, 12 years. I think it takes a ton of users, unique users, recurring users, to make any money. Mobile advertising, if you look at all of the monetization channels, right? Unless you have like massive direct sales teams, you're using backfill ad networks, whether it's AdMob or Millennial or JumpTap, and they're paying, you know, an average of maybe, Olu probably knows best, 50 cent CPM at like a 20% fill rate, 30% fill rate is pretty abysmal, right? Click-through rates are super low as well. They're getting to the point where it's such a commodity, almost as low as online, like 0.1, 0.2%. So you really need numbers. You need masses. And so the folks that are making money are the people with the numbers, like Pandora, for example, with tens of millions of unique users a month, where they can throw in some display interstitials on the app. I don't know if you guys are getting annoyed by their audio interstitials, but yeah, I totally am. That's how they're making money. And it is annoying for the consumer, and they have to do those things to keep the CPMs at a reasonable rate to make money. But we feel like it's the only top 1 or 2% of apps that are making money, that are profitable through mobile advertising, because only 1 or 2% of these apps actually has more than, I'd say the number is like 35 million unique users a month.
Is there a distinction between CPM, CPC, CPA?
Yeah, I mean, if you want to plug into a network, everything is sort of modeled on an effective CPM. So when I said it's a 50 cent effective CPM, they might actually bill on the actual click, but you know the click-through rates are pretty low, so they'll give you an effective CPM. But as an app developer, you should always sign up for a CPM model and not a CPC model, because you want to offload that risk So what that means, 50-cent CPM, for those of you that are not familiar, means for every 1,000 ads that are shown, you get 50 cents. So you need a lot of thousands of ads to generate a couple dollars. So you can just think about the volume and the scale, you know, of ads that you need to serve to get there.
That said, I think we're still at the infancy in mobile advertising. I think that it's still very much using the web paradigm. It's starting to change, certainly, but still very much the beginning. And as advertising begins to take context more and more into account, where are you? What's the time of day? What are you in the midst of doing? What are you doing next? And start to take advantage of that, which is really just starting now. And you can name the networks that have any success with this on like maybe one or two fingers. Things will start to change. You're still gonna need scale, but the CPMs I think are gonna be ratcheting up and up if you can provide that context in a meaningful way. Ideally where you're driving someone to make some sort of a purchase, whether it's in-app or more likely in real world.
So how is advertising going to be different, say, in a year from now? Like, what types of apps are not making money using mobile advertising but will be able to in the near future?
Well, the ads that I'm most excited about right now are those that are driving people to real-world locations. I'm in the local space, so that's what I pay most attention to. But mobile, you have this new context that you didn't have on the web, which is local. And if I know that, you know, it's noon and most people eat lunch and there's a couple of restaurants in your area that are available to you, and you have a network that can start bidding for your business, you can start to see where this is heading, where you're actually going to be driving people toward real-world transactions that are not just buying another game. I mean, when I'm playing Angry Birds on the Android, which is ad-supported, it's just like other games. It's kind of this little loop that you're just running around in circles, not a lot of money to be made in total. Now we're taking that out of just the buy another app to the types of purchases and types of transactions that people are doing anyway in the real world.
There's a, you know, just to jump in on that, I think, you know, the more relevant and contextual the ad is, the more it looks like content, right?
Yeah,
and when you deliver
exactly.
When you deliver content to the user, there's real value there. And I think that's the paradigm cross-platform, whether it's television, radio, online, mobile, that all advertisers are striving towards. Let's create valuable content, give it to consumers. There's a lot of new companies that are emerging now. Companies like Keep, I don't know if you guys read about their funding last week, KIIP. So they're a really interesting company. They call themselves a reward network, and they help mobile gaming publishers essentially attach brands to give rewards to consumers after they've leveled up or powered up, similar to sort of the Massive paradigm that Microsoft purchased a few years ago, but now making it for mobile publishers, mobile game publishers. And that's contextual, that's relevant. There's value there. So you're gonna be able to charge a high CPM and get some clicks as long as you have scale. But I totally agree with Dan said, and just to echo, I think mobile banners, whoever created mobile banners, we always say should be shot, because they literally took the web paradigm and they stuffed it into a small phone, and it's not the same relative intensity as the web on the mobile device. Like, it's much smaller, whoever created that.
Yeah, for a while, they're just getting clicks just because they take up so much of the screen, it's hard not to click.
On like a feature phone, on like when we're serving banners on like the Motorola Razors, which are awesome, by the way, I think I'm gonna go back to one. You know, the banner takes up 3/4 of the thing, so you couldn't do anything but click on it. But now, you know, obviously that the banner paradigm is kind of going away. Even Steve Jobs tried to do something different with the iAd, but he said mobile ads suck. Right, and they do, and there's a ton of innovation that's going to happen to change that space.
And so I think, I agree exactly with Nihal. It's all about the ad being content. The top five publishers that are local publishers are all content as advertising. Groupon, look at Living Social. My God, $400 million just raised. It's content. It's content. People don't see that as an ad. They see that as value that they're extracting from them. And I think we're actually looking at an interesting shift in advertising towards affiliate marketing in many ways. I don't know how many of you use Linkshare or some of the affiliate marketplaces, but with affiliate marketplaces, you can actually choose the ads that you want and put them on your site. It's not a blind network. A blind network, you just get ads pumped in. And if I was a developer, I would, what's going to show up on top of my site? You know, a lot of times I see things that are just not relevant. Whereas affiliate marketing, you actually choose the ads, you choose the and you put them in. So if you go and you choose the travel category, if you have a travel app, you can actually choose those brands that you like and put them in. And then as you start to see this, you can rotate them. So, yeah.
Okay, question right here, Carmen.
What's your opinion of rich media ad platforms like Media Lets and Crisp Wireless?
What's your opinion of Media Lets and Crisp Wireless?
Yeah, I think, I think they're great. I know Eric well, Media Lets. I think they're doing a great job. Even Grace Tribe's getting into this space as well. And they're, clearly taking sort of what iAd created, the buzz and the hype for advertisers, and they're taking it to the next level because they're going cross-platform and they have much more reach. They also don't charge advertisers $1 million up front in hopes that Steve Jobs might talk about you at the next conference. So I think they're awesome. I think the big issue in that space today is that there's no standard, right? So all of these companies are trying to create their own standards. And if they try to do that, then they're not one of them is going to reach real significant scale. So I hope that the IAB, MMA, or some company will say, listen, this is it. This is the rich media ad unit that we're using on mobile, and let's just run with it. I think hopefully that's coming soon.
Well, one thing I'd like to add is, in the advertising space, I think location is going to be particularly interesting. And so companies like Foursquare and Twitter and Yelp, local company in Boston, where they're integrating location and content together so that they look the same. And so when you're at a particular location, you're checking in, you're getting those coupons, that's advertising. And some of the stuff that Twitter's doing is advertising. And it's kind of interesting for me that Facebook really hasn't played their hand on mobile in terms of advertising yet. And I think they're going to be a large player in that geo-local social play as well.
Okay, there's a question right here.
How do you build stickiness into an app?
How do you build stickiness into an app? That's a great question, by the way. I like the length of it.
How much time do we have? I would just say you literally just pour a bunch of glue on your phone.
That's the $1 billion question. That's what everyone wants, and I think there's also thousands of ways to do it. I mean, whether it's game-based behavior, whether it's just other forms of addictive things, whether it's great content that people keep coming back for.
Let me rephrase the question. Yeah. Is that something that keeps you up at night?
I think it keeps
everybody up at night if you're a mobile app developer, right? The stats are a mobile app will have 90% churn after 3 days. That's a real stat, right? I mean,
as in you use it once and don't use it after 3 days.
Yeah, one of the phrases that we use in a particular project that we're working on now is how do you make the application oxygen? How do you make it something that people actually need to use on a day-to-day basis to do what they need to do? And so depending on what field the application is, that may mean different things. So some apps are social, and so that oxygen is really communication. It becomes like the telephone or like talking to someone. In other types of markets, it's an enterprise application where it's oxygen because people actually need to use that application to do their job. So depending on what you're doing, and what type of application you're building, if you can make the application fundamentally critical to the person's use, it becomes much more sticky. And if your application is more on the novelty side or more on I could take it or I could leave it, it's kind of nice to have. If it's a nice to have, it's a lot of people will say, okay, I'll delete it. If it's I need this, it's solving a real problem, it's going to be much more sticky.
If you need it, it's going to be oxygen. If it's a nice to have, you got to make it crack.
Right.
That's the alternative.
Yeah. There's an app that's sort of maybe self-named crack called, I forget the name of it, but you have to take a picture of yourself every day, right? And so after a year, it'll do this really cool montage of you kind of evolving. So that's built-in stickiness, right? That's kind of clever. Shit, I got to use this thing every day.
But even that's it doesn't, it's a novelty, right? You could do it for a week and be like, okay, this is lame. The types of things that are really you can't get rid of it is, it's helping me, like maps, or it helps me get home. It diagnoses certain medical things that I need to get diagnosed. It does, thinking about kind of how do you make it more important? How do you make it really integrated into a person's life, their calendar, a recurring thing that they do over and over again?
This guy right here is going to ask a question.
So how does Shazam, compare to Angry Birds?
How does Shazam compare to Angry Birds in terms of
revenues?
Revenues and usage.
I don't know the latest numbers, but I think Angry Birds did they have 60 million, I think, downloads and significant.
100 million. I think 100 million. 100 million.
Maybe 100 million downloads, 60 million actives a month. Maybe those are the numbers. So
100 million downloads a month.
No, 100 million downloads total.
Okay.
Yeah, 60 million of those are active.
Crack.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not sure about Shazam. I feel like Shazam had definitely a market leadership position a couple of years ago. Now it's relatively commoditized. There's a lot of services that incorporate that same sort of, you know, music ID technology. So I'm not sure about the numbers, but I'm sure Angry Birds is doing much better today.
Okay. I see we have a question from Boston that's going to come up on the next slide. So I just want to close out on the mobile commerce as a revenue model. So there's a set of companies out there that may or may not be online. You know, we got Pizza Hut and The Gap, clearly are not necessarily online businesses. Who's doing the most clever things with selling physical products using mobile applications? And who's making a lot of money doing that?
eBay is selling tons of auctions being closed every day on the mobile device. It's kind of, the mobile is perfect for eBay because it's about time. So you, like, wherever you are, you need to be that last bidder. You use a mobile phone. I mean, I've personally bought a bunch of stuff on eBay lately using my mobile phone, and they've been releasing some really interesting stats too of where and when people are buying.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other e-commerce, mobile commerce?
Yeah, I would say Amazon is a really interesting one to look at. They are moving really heavily into mobile, you know, across multiple platforms. In terms of commerce, you know, we're working with a couple interesting companies. One is Rulala, which is kind of a time-based, you know, marketplace for buying products. We also recently released an interesting app called Swap.com, which is kind of like eBay. It allows you to scan the books in your house and the CDs and DVDs and swap them for other stuff that you want. And so there's a lot of these businesses that are trying to figure out how to move product from, you know, warehouses into your home or between people and individuals. So that's definitely something that you're going to see more and more of. So
is Rulala a daily deal site?
Yeah, it's kind of like a Gilt and those types of things.
So what are daily deal sites doing, particularly in mobile, and who's the smartest in that space?
Biased.
So I know Groupon, I know this is a public fact, but they say about 30% of their revenue now is coming from mobile. So that's a big chunk, right? Last year they did like $600 million in revenue. I'm sure they're growing much faster than that. So they're doing a ton of transactions on the mobile device. They're releasing an app soon called Groupon Now. So it's the Groupon model that's in reverse. So you basically can download an iPhone app and say, instead of looking at a deal, you can say, I'm hungry or I'm thirsty. And so it kind of reverses the, you know, supply and demand. And so now they'll have actual merchants bidding on consumers, and they'll drive even more transactions, I think, through mobile.
Okay.
It's a need to have now. It's not an option to be on mobile. I mean, for these guys, I mean, because of the nature of the business. I mean, Gilt has a beautiful app. Everyone does.
Question right here. Development, a preference on development platform, I guess is the question.
That's a good question. I mean, I think Greg, I'm sure he's going to have some, he's a developer on the panel, going to have some interesting opinions on it. You kind of need to be cross-platform now because people are on different devices, and Android is now bigger than iOS in aggregate. So you either go build an app for every device, build apps using frameworks that translate, or build mobile web and maybe have an app strategy that relates to mobile web. And we could speak the whole panel on these decisions, but you shouldn't be a one app, one platform only company unless there's a specific reason why that platform is right for you.
Okay.
Yeah, we typically advise companies to pick a platform to start on and prove that you're successful. So it is, unless you're a large brand, it's difficult to launch on multiple platforms at the same time just because of the cost associated. So we typically recommend to start on one platform. Historically, people have requested to start on iPhone. It's a leading edge technology platform. Android is catching up, so that trend may change over the years. It has not yet. In terms of re-leveraging some of the technology between apps, the places that you can leverage the most is on the back end in your infrastructure. So a lot of these companies will develop the infrastructure and the APIs on the back end, the server pieces, and that piece is definitely reusable between an iPhone and an Android app. You can also oftentimes reuse the user interface, but as far as the code goes, you know, we tend to advocate building native applications. There are other platforms and technologies that are middleware platforms. You know, PhoneGap was mentioned. There's a couple others as well. For various reasons, we tend not to recommend those. So, but you know, people would disagree with me on that. But I think for building A-class applications, that's what you have to do.
Okay. The one caveat I'd add to what Greg said, is that if you're building something where you're leveraging social and you require kind of someone's entire social graph to be able to use the application, or at least like 95% of them, then starting out with just one platform can backfire on you because it won't be useful to those people if not everyone they know can use it.
Okay, here's a good question from Boston. So what industry is least mature from a mobility standpoint? Is there's saturation on check-ins, social networks, geo-based, and photo stuff. What is untapped?
We recently made a couple investments, this was mentioned early on, in the enterprise space. And I think, so there's a company called Mighty Meeting, for example, that's a mobile WebEx. You can literally use your iPhone and move slides and it'll, you know, broadcast them, the presentation, wherever anybody is. Another company called Breezy, where you can print a document and it'll show up at the printer nearest to you, whether it's a FedEx Kinko's or a public library or a university, based on mapping literally all the public printers in the world. And I think there's a recent company called 3LM, and literally 3 months after they were funded, they got acquired by Motorola. So I think the enterprise space is an area, you know, that generally the B2B space, I think, is an area that is going to see a lot of innovation, where there hasn't been a ton of saturation yet.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think, you know, the e-commerce area that you just discussed, I think there's a lot of room for innovation, especially with social shopping.
Social shopping.
Yeah, I think there's still a lot. You don't see it as much as the opportunity arises. I mean, Macy's is starting to get into it and some of the others, but it's still, there's room for new Zappos in mobile, for sure.
Zappos in mobile, okay. Let's talk about mobile payments. So what ways are people taking payment over their mobile phone, and where's the volume in that market?
I think mobile payments is still up for grabs, largely. It's, you know, the carriers, I think globally, probably had a pretty big opportunity to become the gateways. You know, as Matt probably agrees with me, he's been in this space longer than me, you know, they completely screwed themselves by charging right out of the gate on a premium SMS front, for example, such a big surcharge. So what that means is, you know, you can go to Japan, for example, and text in on a soda machine, get your soda, it's charged to your bill. The carrier there, NTT, might only take 10% or 5%, so it makes it viable for a Coca-Cola or somebody to distribute through the carrier. Here in the U.S., you know, carriers will want up to 30 or 40%. And that hasn't come down. So it's leaving a lot of innovation for folks, companies like Venmo, it's a P2P payment like PayPal, but over SMS, companies like Square that are enabling long-tail merchants to be able to take, using their iPhone or iPad, be able to accept credit card payments. But I think I think the space is wide open. We haven't really found a solution.
Yeah, and I think the apps where you have that, again, tied to loyalty, where the user registers, puts their credit card, and then it's just one button just to pay, and yeah, you create that kind of scenario. There's a parking service that uses an app in Vancouver, and every time you park, you just boom, and it really is easy. If you want to put more money in the meter, boom, just hit the button, and you pay. You don't have to worry about it, and you don't have to think about your credit card. So I think these loyalty prepaid in that space, a lot of room for growth and opportunity, yeah, in all
another,
the verticals.
There's another app that's highly addictive called Uber, and they just launched in New York a couple days ago. You can download it. UBR, literally link your credit card. I think I racked up like $2,000 on Uber in Austin during South by Southwest. So I was allowed to like call limos, which was really cool because I spent so much money. But I'm not gonna do that.
What can you can buy anything with Uber, or what can you buy?
No, sorry. It locates where you are, and you can actually see town cars and limos if you're a special like me. Town cars, if you spent $2,000 in 2 days, town cars around your location, and you can just say, I want to be picked up. And your credit card is attached to it. It'll charge your credit card, and literally you'll have a timer on how many minutes and seconds the driver will be at your location. So it's pretty convenient. You're going to end up paying probably twice as much as a cab, and probably use it 50 times more often. But
there's a couple of interesting payment technologies that are still emerging that I think you're going to see over the next couple of years. One of them is Nearfield, which is starting to emerge on Android. And this is the ability to use your phone to tap on something and either check in or pay or have interactions. It's still kind of early stage. You know, we haven't seen this deployed by a lot of carriers yet, but we also haven't seen kind of the large players, the MasterCards and Visas, coming out with applications or terminals that make interaction with the phone simple. You know, some of the people in retail, like Starbucks, are innovating on their own, and they're creating their own apps and their own payment systems and their own technology to kind of facilitate that process. But it's still kind of early stages with a lot of the retailers. They haven't, you know, it's a complex problem.
And it's frustrating because it is so fragmented. I mean, Japan is 10 years, I hate to say, ahead of us at NFC. You walk into McDonald's, you scan your phone, they're getting 80 million users using this. I did a recent white paper on it about it. It's just because all the carriers came together, all the credit cards came together, and they just said, let's just choose one system. So I think the recent announcement by the mobile operators here in North America is a good start. And once they all come together, because you just, it's got to be a convenience thing. But it's been a challenge because it's been so fragmented. But I think
NFC will be the standard. You know, iPhone 5 will have it. All Android devices are shipping with it. Google is about to announce a big deal with Verifone.
They announced it last week, I think. They announced Verifone, Citibank, and MasterCard.
Yeah, that's great. So basically, Verifone powers majority of credit card swipers at merchants, and now you'll be able to walk in with your Android device and just tap your phone on it, like you can do with, you know, inside cabs.
All right, let's switch gears a little bit to marketing and distribution. So you built an app. It's going to make you money somehow. How do you get people to know about it and download it? What's effective for that?
I think it used to be that you could, you know, in the early days, the sort of cowboy days of the App Store, you could write an app and you could put it in the App Store and, you know, everyone would show up in your door and you'd have thousands of downloads a day. I mean, we did that with one of our early apps, you know, spent a little time on it, put it in the App Store, had 10,000 downloads, we were ecstatic. And those days are long gone. You know, there are 300,000 apps or more, you know, in the iPhone store, you know, closely approaching that number on Android as well. You know, it's just going to accelerate. And so, you know, I tell companies to think about kind of how they would monetize a website. You know, nobody says, like, oh my God, there's millions and millions of websites. How's my business ever going to succeed? And it's becoming the same thing on mobile. There's lots, so you have to use a lot of traditional marketing tactics. You know, you have to have a great product, you have to have a great story, you have to solve a real problem, you have to be unique. You know, a lot of the traditional things that you need in a great product, you need mobile to tell that story and to be successful.
So social features is another way to, I agree completely with everything Greg said, another way to expose your app, because who are the best people to recommend your app, but people who like it, who you trust? So if you can build in some way that really feels like it's part of the experience, ideally, where you're actually sharing maybe information about what you've done in the app or some media that was created in the application or a high score or something, and making that available to your graph, then you could really spread things quickly like that.
Yeah, I think there's a solution, AppBoy, which is an API that, you know, check in of when you're using your app, your friends can see that you're using the app. And I think those types of services, the whole social paradigm, is really powerful.
Okay, Nihal, I think you were talking when I spoke with you about the value of a top position on a leaderboard and how once you're up on the top X number of apps, that's where people see and you'll get a lot more downloads that way. So what's the value of being top on a leaderboard and how do you get there?
Yeah, I think, you know, the discovery on the iPhone, you know, obviously when you're looking for apps through iTunes, the first screen is, I think, the first 25 apps, and then the second screen is 50. Online is the top 100. I don't think they do 100 yet on the phone. So when you're in that top 100 or top 50 in any category. You have extremely significantly more visibility, essentially, to consumers, to the point where I think the last time we were looking at this, to enter the top 100 apps overall, I think it was something like 20, you had to have 20,000 downloads a day or 15,000 downloads. Then if you're in the top, that's top 100, top 50 is almost like 50,000 downloads a day. Top 25 gets to now it's like 75,000 downloads a day. So that's, you know, obviously it seems challenging to get there, but you know, to get there now, there's a lot more opportunities that developers have. So if you have a product that works, that's sticky, what we recommend is running media buys, right? Where you can spend up to like a fixed amount, like 25 cents a download, if you can time it with press, to essentially, we call it carpe diem, to punch you into the top sort of 100 spot. And then it's kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy, because when you're in the top 100, you have that much more visibility that you're going to get more and more downloads. And so some companies have tactically done this really well. There's a company in LA called Goji. It's free group text messaging. They do about 30 million texts a day. And they started out literally by just buying traffic to stay in the top 50. And I think they've been in the top 50 or even 25 for the past 3 months. So you can imagine how many downloads they've amassed. So it is partially a science. Oh, so
what do you mean by downloads?
By buying downloads. So you know, there's a lot of ad networks out there with a lot of remnant inventory. So AdMob is a good example. Graystripe is a good example. There's other companies called Tapjoy. Some are on this slide. Tapjoy, Pinch and Flurry, or it's called Pinch, I guess. They have a mobile discovery network called App Circle. And so what a developer can do, or a publisher, you can actually just pay Tapjoy, say, $10,000, right? And they will guarantee you 40,000 downloads. You're buying each download for 25 cents. Now, the users might not be super targeted. They might not be relevant. They'll download it. They might not come back to the app again. But because iTunes is correlated in that way, where they rank the top 50 or top 100 based on downloads, you can scientifically get into the top 100, top 50. Of course, you're not going to stay there if your app sucks, but you can definitely get there. If you have a good app with good numbers, I mean, these guys would probably speak better to that than me, but if you're seeing retention pretty high, in other words, you don't have 90% churn, you know, which is better than most, then worth a gamble.
We've seen those types of things be great for a launch. It's very hard to maintain an app. Basically, the App Store has gravity. It likes new stuff. You know, people like to see new stuff. The top 100 apps overall are stickier. You know, so if you're, like, we've been in the top 25 of various different categories, and it is really difficult to stay there because there's always something new coming along. There's always something to compete with it. If you get some gravity, some inertia with your application, it is easier to stay there, but you need quality to stay there. You know, a lot of the things you see rise really quickly and fall very quickly. Kind of the number one sort of, if you're in the top anything, you know, and you just got there, you know, I caution developers to never take out a calculator and hit times 365, because, you know, you're like, I'm making it, and you're like so excited, and then, you know, one day later you're like, oh, got 3 downloads today. And so some of these, you know, services, they're primarily advertising or advertising related, where users are exposed to your application. They may get, you know, a free, you know, axe in some game if they download some other game. And so that's how they will get downloads, and that will basically put you on some of the top charts. It can be very expensive. And, you know, we've played around with a couple different services. One made us the number 3 overall app in the App Store, number 1 app in Japan. Another app, you know, we spent a lot of money and nothing happened. And so you just have to know what, you know, you have to be careful and know what you're doing. And my company, Raise Labs, we had a clock radio application. It was a utility that we promoted. It did really well, and it's doing okay so far.
Okay. Top tip for marketing a mobile app, other than anything that's been mentioned or hasn't been mentioned.
Well, one thing I wanted to mention is that less is more, the alerts. And I think that, you know, leveraging that alert, that reminder, gives that, it helps with the stickiness, but it also, I think if you get a lot, if you get 10 messages coming in, people, it's overbearing, but just simplistic things that catch people's attention.
Simplistic things. Okay. Any other top tips for marketing an iPhone app?
I would say the three things that people are exposed to very quickly when they see your app is the app name, the app icon, and the first screenshot. And a lot of people throw those three things together, and I would actually recommend you think about those very carefully, how people are going to see your app, how they're going to search for your app and find it in the App Store, because that has a huge impact on your downloads.
And also I think that, one of the things we discussed earlier is the cross-platform. I think it's very important to have a mobile website, and it's very important to really get your keywords right and your SEO so that, you get the discovery where people hit your landing page and download it.
Okay, so SEO, mobile SEO, or
just
SEO.
SEO. Yeah, you have to master Google.
Okay, gotcha. Any other tips, or we're going to go on to designing and building apps?
Yeah, I have a quick question with regard to that.
Okay. How important is it to have a .com domain extension for SEO purposes?
Well, Google has really done quite well in the mobile index as well as the existing online index. But my belief is really keep the brand the same, keep it .com, and then do an m.site.com, and then make sure that everything on your regular site and the mobile site are very systematic. So if somebody tweets, or if you tweet, if they hit your website, they can then get information on the app and download through your website or through the mobile site.
Okay. Greg, you want to add something?
I was just gonna say I think the service has to be great. Whatever it is, we've seen services like Delicious, in its heyday with a really hard to spell domain name, and Bitly with the Libyan domain name. If your service is great, it can do fine, so it just has to make sense. I have a .me domain sitting around. Maybe I'll use it one day.
Sonar just won the pitch competition here with a .me domain. Okay, so designing and building apps. So the question is, so let's start off with why should an app be on a mobile phone as opposed to on a desktop? Like what makes something better on a mobile phone?
Well, I think it's been really the three things that are one of them is being pictures, like we discussed earlier, the ability to upload and do that through an app, the APIs that you can't do through the browser. So picture, the offline mode, and all of the different the features that just make it more mobile.
The camera.
I mean offline mode. You think of it, you're on the train. If you didn't have an app, if you couldn't use your phone, It makes sense today. I mean, the world isn't where everything is. We always say always on, but in reality, everything isn't always on. And so that offline mode is
offline mode. Okay, so Greg, specifically comparing mobile apps to desktop apps, why be on mobile?
Yeah, I would say the reason you should be thinking mobile is because in today's culture, you have three things with you. You have your wallet, you have your phone, and maybe your keys. And so it's one of the core things that you carry with you. You don't always carry your computer with you. You don't always carry your tablet, iPad with you. It's something that allows your business and your company to impact people in all aspects of their life, in all times of the day. People put their phones on their nightstand right next to them in case they need them. So it's something that is very personal, much more personal, I believe, than a personal computer. It's just there, it's with you, you have a very intimate relationship, and so companies that want that intimate relationship need to be thinking, how do I get closer to my users by getting on their device?
Anything else? Nahal, why build a mobile app as opposed to just a website?
Yeah, I think geo is my biggest thing, for sure. Context with cross-section of location and time, being able to target where you are at a specific time, I think there's going to be a lot of applications. Foursquare's, I think they kind of, just are at the tip of the iceberg in terms of things that are going to emerge.
Okay. What about go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, in terms of web versus native, which was sort of part
that's
of the question.
Yeah, that's the second question I was going to ask. So why build a mobile website as opposed to, or a mobile app versus a mobile website?
Yeah, I guess the, you know, if you think about two things, one, discovery, and the other thing that I think is really important is performance and user experience. And so I think in terms of discovery, people are now being trained that they go to the app store to find apps. And so, you know, if you have a relationship with a brand, you know their brand, you may type their website into a browser and have that web experience. But if you want a spot on their home screen, you know, people are being trained and they're learning that process of going to the app store. The other one is kind of great user experience. And so because these devices have smaller CPUs, you know, performance is really important and you want that great smooth user experience. And it's very challenging to achieve that level of smoothness on a mobile app. You see lots and lots of companies have tried, you know, one of the best, you know, some of the best companies in the world are trying to create great mobile web apps, and they're having a really hard time.
So I'll just add a third to that, which is monetization, because an application is built into an app store, there it's a lot easier to make that purchase. There are ways to do this on the web. I mean, but if you've ever tried entering your credit card number or trying to sign into PayPal and go through the several steps to do that on the web, it's a lot harder to do.
I think the future is HTML5 mobile web. It's very analogous to sort of what happened on the PC with, you know, installing software off your CD and now everything's in the cloud. I think the limiting factor is that the network speeds are not there yet to create a real seamless experience for downloading, you know, really rich content on the mobile web. But we're just around the corner from LTE and 4G networks. For an example, you can download this mobile publisher actually in Canada called UKEN. They just create HTML5 mobile games, and if you're connected on Wi-Fi, and literally you're just in your browser, and it looks like a really awesome, like, you know, fully featured rich media. You would think it's an app, and it's all HTML5. Now of course you take it and you run it on AT&T's New York 3G network, right? It falls apart. So I think a limiting factor is network speeds, and as soon as that happens, I think the same thing that happened in the PC world, it's going to happen in the mobile world. Apps, the App Store, iTunes control of that is going to be completely disintermediated, and we're going to have actually a much more open system on HTML5.
Yeah, look, I wish you were right.
I agree, but I think we're still two years away from that. I think it's network speed is one thing, but I think another major thing is just, well, the maturity of HTML5 and an understanding of developers of like how to really use it in a mobile way, which I think will only come with time and iteration and learning, which is a few years out.
When I was at Microsoft, I was on the Windows XP team, and we actually did a lot of experimentation and prototyping with web HTML technology as user interface. And we said, this is the future. We're gonna, you know, be building pieces of Windows using HTML5, and it was always 1 or 2 years off, and it's always been 1 or 2 years off for the last 10 years. And so,
Microsoft has been 1 or 2 years off.
Fair criticism. But, you know, as far as desktop apps, you know, the quality of, you know, the Adobes of the world who are building, you know, the Autodesks, the SolidWorks, you know, there are reasons to be desktop native and performant. There's certainly, you know, I don't want to build an Android app and a BlackBerry app and a Windows Mobile 7 app and a, you know, Hewlett Packard app, and, you know, I want some consolidation from as a developer, but, you know, I'm pessimistic about the future of HTML.
I don't know. I'm in Nihal's camp, and I think the reason is that I use all of my Google apps today, every day, multiple times a day, and they're all in HTML5. My Google Gmail is in HTML5, Calendar, YouTube, all HTML5.
What is the fundamental difference between HTML4 and HTML5? What does 5 give you that 4 doesn't?
Well, I'm not that technical to give you those details.
It's a much more
5 is the answer to all the questions.
In a nutshell, it's a more dynamic experience, like within a web frame of some sort. Yeah. There's technologies behind it, but
it's a buzzword. It's a buzzword. Yeah. I mean, it's if you unravel it, you know, it's you know, we used to call it DHTML, and we used to call it Ajax, and then we called it, you know, HTML5. I mean, fundamentally, it's the canvas tag. It's some low-level things in the HTML rendering infrastructure. It's some new technologies. But, you know, it's a lot of the same stuff that we had 4 or 5 years ago, you know. The video tag is new. Geolocation is new. And these are all great things. But, you know, a lot of the fundamental things you see in web apps that are calling themselves HTML5 are very similar to web apps that you were seeing, you know, 4 or 5 years ago.
But the beauty with having an HTML5 or a website is when a user goes to it through search, it's there immediately. It loads very quickly. With an app, they have to download it, and you know, they see the page, they have to download it. So I think that, you know, depending on your application, a utility or, like I said, Google Apps have done quite well in HTML5. But if you get in situations where you really need to use those APIs, which really make your app, and as you mentioned earlier, it's about the business model, where you need the camera, you want to use the camera, you want to use the accelerometers, you want to use the offline mode.
Okay. Can I do an audience poll? And people in Boston can participate. How many people have a smartphone? How many people have Gmail? How many people use the native application? How many people have native application?
The native iPhone app.
Native iPhone app for email. HTML5 mail app. A couple. So good, but
Searching mail, you got to use it. Right?
So I mean, today I agree that, you know, because of network speeds, again, AT&T, et cetera, in New York, the app is definitely a better experience. But I think in the future, it's all going to go to HTML5.
Also, device storage is an issue.
Device storage, but I'm saying the trend today, I'll give it to you. But next year, we'll be back up here, and I'll be smiling. another example, sort of point of the future, a company called OnSwipe. They actually create, like, literally translate blogs. Like, if you have a WordPress blog, they make it HTML5 compliant for a tablet, and it's beautiful. It looks like a fully featured rich media app, and you have all these styles and all these templates. So check it out, and you'll be blown away. You'll think this is a huge app that you have to download, and it's really not. I think, again, I'll see you in a year.
To be clear, I would love HTML5 to be successful, and there's actually a couple interesting companies, CentureTouch and jQuery Mobile, that are trying to solve a lot of these technical problems, and I really hope they do, but it's quite a challenge.
We'll see. Boston performed the poll. They raised their hands, and they said they all have smartphones in Boston, and they all use Gmail, but nobody uses the Gmail app.
Yes, I love you, Boston.
All native email. So, okay, we'll take maybe two more questions. I think there's one in Boston, and we'll go for Ilya first.
So on the topic of cross-platform developers, I know Greg kind of gave us his opinion. I just wanted to ask the other panelists, you know, in terms of native, PhoneGap, Titanium, or HTML5, you know, what are you guys doing?
It depends on the application. I mean, for our Socialite core applications, our frameworks, native, but we have some things we're building right now that are using our API for really specific things, like in the music area, where we want to do something that's for certain reasons that we're probably going to use PhoneGap and CentureTouch to do it. But there's still a lot of advantage to native. Yeah.
There's a couple other frameworks like Mobile Roadie, AppMaker. They can spit out HTML5 apps pretty quickly.
Okay. So our last question then from Boston, which I think is interesting. So we've heard about GPS and NFC. Are there signs of more utilization of the other sensors that are built into mobile phones these days?
The microphone. A microphone is having a renaissance. I mean, applications that tell what you're watching when you're watching TV and when you're watching shows I don't watch.
Like Shazam kind of themes.
Yeah, Shazam kind of thing. And color, which it's... using the microphone to figure out your context, where you are and who you're near, stuff like that. Yeah, that's exciting stuff.
Nielsen actually has this like secret project. I'm probably gonna get shot after I leave here, but basically every commercial and television show has an audio fingerprint that humans can't hear or dogs can't hear or whatever, but your phone can hear. So, you know, imagine a social sort of TV check-in app that leverages this type of technology. It's just sitting there listening to Dan's point, and it'll know what you're watching.
Shopkick is doing this for retail. Like, they've got hundreds or thousands of retail locations. All the major chains around the country have these little speakers in there, and you're running the app. The app, and it's inaudible to the human ear, but
my dog freaks out when I walk into Best Buy, though. No, I wouldn't. I don't know about Shopkick.
You know, I think people are.
Are you serious? I'm totally serious.
Wow. People are utilizing all the different sensors on the device in different ways, and so you know, from the accelerometer, you know, a lot of games are using the accelerometer to figure out where you're tilting it. The microphone's a great example. We're going to see more applications using the forward-facing camera to kind of where your head is and what you're looking at and other things like that. So basically anything that is a sensor, you know, developers are going to look for ways that they can augment the user experience of that device and make it more engaging, more compelling.
Okay, I'm going to wrap up then with my favorite question momentarily. So other than your own, who is the smartest company in the mobile space? Who wants to start?
Apple. I think they're doing a lot of really smart things. I mean, I think the advertisers as well, who are, you know, in terms of who's making money at advertising, you know, I think the Apples, the Googles, the Tapjoys.
Apple and Google. Okay, so we've got the big ones out of the way. Dan, who's your nomination?
Mine was going to be Apple too, honestly. sorry, but I mean, I've been in this business for a long time too, and like, they came out in 2007 with the iPhone and just changed the entire game, and they continue to do it over and over again. It's like...
Okay. So Nihal and Matthew are not allowed to use Apple. So other than your own, who's the smartest company in the mobile space?
Well, I think recent sort of statistics in the past 2 weeks are pointing to Android growing incredibly fast, faster than Apple, faster than iPhone, especially on a global level. So don't want to necessarily give my hats off to Google, but they're definitely doing it well from an OS perspective. I think from an advertising perspective, they still have a lot of work to do. But
Google.
I think with Larry Page running the show again, it'll be interesting.
I don't want to say Google, so I'm going to say I'm looking at Facebook.
Facebook.
I think when they were doing when Dave Morin told me they were hitting their 1 million users of mobile a day and the penetration of mobile, I think Facebook will really will do some amazing things with mobile.
Okay.
And we just haven't seen it yet.
Okay. Awesome. So this is my advice to the panelists. Statement. So when I wrap up the panel, which is going to be in about 10-20 seconds. Everybody's going to want to come down and talk to you, but we need to be out of this room by 9:30, which is in 8 minutes. And if you allow people to talk to you, we won't get out, and then NYU will be upset with us. So you can talk to everybody here at the bar, which is just on the block. Murphy and Gonzalez. Who, show of hands on the panel, is going to Murphy and Gonzalez for a drink? All right, everyone. So everyone, that's go to Murphy and Gonzalez. Thank you very much,
you're
Nihal.
Buying, right?
I'm buying, absolutely. Nihal, Dan, Greg, and Matthew, thanks very much.
Thank you.